A soggy Saturday in Greenville, South Carolina, as the Furman Paladins make their final playoff push as they take on Point. The Furman Paladins rank 17th in the nation, looking to make one final statement as they wrap up the regular season, taking on the Point Skyhawks. And good afternoon, everybody. Welcome inside Paladin Stadium, along with the legendary coach, Sam Weich. I'm Bob Mahalik. Glad you could be with us. We'll explain a little bit later on why Point is on the schedule for Furman, but the important thing for the Paladins is finish strong. You got this final home game, final game of the regular season. Make a statement.
Finish strong, go 8-4. 8-4 puts you in a much better position to have a home field advantage for that first playoff game. They are ready to play, and they should take nothing for granted, even though it's a small school from West Point, Georgia.
Yeah, the Skyhawks, an NAIA school. They show up here today, and they've got a puncher's chance because they've got a really good running back in Marquez Jackson.
He does everything. He's a receiver. He can run. He's 5'8", 180 pounds, but he's quick.
Now, the weather conditions may indicate that these running backs are going to get a lot of touches. And that's good news for the Furman Paladins because Devin Wynn is one of the best. He's having a 1,000-yard season.
And the good news is he's coming back next year. He's only a junior, but he is a leading rusher for the Paladins and one of the top rushers in the nation.
And he knows how to find the end zone. Had a 5-touchdown game earlier this season. So Devin Wynn and the Paladins looking to make one final statement as they prepare for the playoffs by taking on Point. We'll kick it off when we come back.
Something brought us here, to a time and a place where your decisions can actually drive change. Where extra achievers become ultra-curricular. Where a private institution serves a greater public mission. At Furman University, opportunity is all around you. So take our commitment, combine it with everything you're capable of, and the world will be forced to take notice.
You a new car?
Hey, Gigi, check it out.
Oh, this kid gets me.
And there's a hot tub in the back.
Come on in, ladies. Water aerobics with these guys.
Have mercy.
Your life could be exciting enough. If not, play Powerball.
The madness of March begins in Asheville, North Carolina. Be at the Harris Cherokee Center Asheville March 5th through 9th for the 2020 Ingalls SoCon Basketball Championship presented by General Shale. You don't want to miss the action on the court as all 18 SoCon men's and women's teams compete for a conference championship and a berth in the NCAA tournament. Book your travel and tickets by logging on to SoConHoops.com or by contacting the Harris Cherokee Center Asheville box office. The madness begins here. Get your tickets today.
It was beautiful yesterday in Greenville, South Carolina. It's supposed to be beautiful tomorrow. It is not right now. A front is moving over the area. It has been raining since about 7 o'clock this morning. We expect rain to continue throughout the game, so it's a rainy 57-degree day, but we've got that great synthetic turf out there. That shouldn't be a problem. We'll have a wet football. But we have a football team in the Furman Paladins ready to make that final statement, ready to say not only should we be a higher seed, but we should host a postseason game. The playoffs start next week, but right now it's a game against Point. And quickly, if you're wondering how Point, an NAIA school, winds up on the schedule, well, it's quite complicated, but there was a team that dropped out 2 years ago, and then the conference schedule turned out this way for Furman, where the final game of the season would have been a bye. You don't want to have two byes going into the playoffs, and so they work out an arrangement to bring Point to town. And we're underway, and Furman and Point are going to play a football game. And Point is coached by a very familiar name, Julius Dixon, a captain of the 89 championship team who knows an awful lot about Furman. So Julius Dixon able to come back, bring his Point team, and play against his alma mater. And his friend Clay Hendricks, who he's teammate with.
Right, good friends and teammates and on special times for Furman. They were winning national titles at that point.
And, of course, Coach Dixon was a coach for Furman for about a decade in the 90s and the 2000s. And now he's got himself a challenge to make Point a winner in the NAIA. Here's Furman's first offensive play. It's Devin Wynn, the 1,000-yard rusher, picking up 5 yards on first down. And the starting quarterback today for the Furman Paladins, they go back to Darren Granger.
Darren Granger started the season as the starter. There was competition during training camp and during spring practice between Hamp Simpson and Darren. But Granger starts today.
And he'll throw on second down. Complete to the senior, Thomas Gordon, playing his final regular season home game. Gets it right to the 35-yard line, and that will be a first down for Furman. And there's Coach Clay Hendricks. His goal this year was to win the SoCon championship outright and earn that automatic bid. But he's got his team positioned to get into the postseason, something he did in his first year here at Furman. Now he's hoping to do in his third.
I think it's another step forward, and it's a slower process than people want it to be. When you get to, you want to be a perennial champion and also a perennial powerhouse. They're headed that way.
They're ranked 17th in the nation. We're ranked in the top 10 until last week's disappointing loss on the road at Wofford. On first down, they'll run it up the gut. And Devin Wynn will break free and almost go the distance. He got tripped up after picking up 17 yards. He saw the goal line ahead of him but couldn't quite get there as his feet wouldn't carry him the rest of the way.
The offensive line really should and did on this drive right here overpower. You can see the movement backwards pushing those defensive linemen who are not quite as big as the offensive line that Furman presents.
So Wynn almost had his 14th touchdown of the season, but he stumbled out of the gate. The pitch goes back to Wayne Anderson. Anderson had a long first quarter touchdown last week against Wofford that put Furman up early in the ballgame. The freshman showing his speed on that run against Wofford, and he's quite a talent. And these young men from Point, from the state of Georgia, right down there in West Point, right on the border between Alabama and Georgia, well, you see an awful lot of Georgia high school players on the field, and Wayne Anderson's one of those. He's not one of those. He comes from Texas, but you'll see others from the Georgia area, from the Atlanta area, prominent throughout both of these rosters today. Good decision by Granger to go to the option. Pitch it back to Corey Watkins. Speaking of a guy from Georgia, the Evans, Georgia native, takes it down inside the 20-yard line.
It's good strategy, good play selection. When Wynn broke that one run up the middle, they've had a pitch to the right and a pitch to the left. Both of them went picking up good yards. That one, big-time yards.
Well, the two big differences between these schools when you move up in class, you've got an NAIA school playing a SoCon school. You know Furman's stronger. You know they're faster. And we're seeing that in the first couple of plays. They're moving bodies around, and when they get to the edge, they are hard to run down. Granger on the option. We'll keep. Turn it up. Darren Granger, touchdown, Paladins.
That's a drive that they wanted and that we expected to see against Point University. But remember, we've seen drives like that against SoCon teams, too, and Furman Paladins are good enough to do it against anybody.
We've also seen them go for two out of that formation that they're showing on the field now, so we won't get tricked by it. They'll go back into the extra point formation after spreading things out, and Grayson Atkins will go for the point after. That's the opening drive that the Paladins wanted. They want to find that rhythm again, find their confidence again, coming off a disappointing loss last week, in which they scored early. As we just mentioned, they scored early against Wofford. They score early again here today. So the Furman Paladins playing their final regular season home game. make a statement on the opening drive as they march right downfield and punch it in. Darren Granger does the honors. Furman leads 7-0. It's not very often that Furman is the big school, but they are in comparison to Point out of West Point, Georgia. They were founded back in 1937. Great mascot, great uniforms. The Skyhawks play in the NAIA, where they're successful. 3-2 conference record, 5-6 overall. And, of course, you know the Furman Paladins here in Greenville, South Carolina, with Sir Paladin being their mascot. Grayson Atkins usually puts it into the end zone, but this one is returnable. Out past the 25 to the 29-yard line, so decent field position for Point as they take over on offense. And now Point will rotate a couple of quarterbacks in and out too, but what's important, Coach, at this point for Point is to play mistake-free football on offense. I mean, you know you're up against it against Furman. You got a little bit of difficult weather conditions, but you can't turn the football over and make a lot of mistakes.
Well, it's a golden rule for the underdog in any game. You can't give away points or you can't give away field position, which you would be doing if you were to fumble here on the first couple of snaps. And you want to express to your better opponent, that you're going to be able to stand up against them.
Paladins show blitz on first down, and they'll bring it against Keenan Wise, and Wise's pass goes incomplete. So Wise gets the start at quarterback. Last week against Bluefield, he was 9 of 20 for 80 yards, threw a couple interceptions, did run one in. Wise had time, threw behind the receiver. Intended receiver was Bartley.
Used two quarterbacks, just like Furman has used two quarterbacks during the course of the season. Wise gets it today, though.
You can see the Point's going to be aggressive, throwing on first down and throwing on second. Ball goes through the fingertips incomplete. Trying to set up a little screen to the near side, the second time Bartley was targeted in as many plays. You see the wet football there, Coach, as it came out of the hands quickly, a little bit of a duck on a wet day.
The ball won't be real wet because it's really not raining right now. It has been raining, so the turf is going to be wet. And where the ball sits, just opposite the laces, is a wet spot. That's the only thing they've got to be careful about it.
Controlled rollout. Good throw there and complete. An absolute laser, and Point has their first big play of the football game. And Timothy Gary gets drilled towards the end of the play. So Gary, an all-conference performer, picks up 35 yards on a pass, catch, and run.
Good rollout by the quarterback to the left. The tough way to throw is going against the grain if you're a right-hander going to the left. Throws a strike right there just above the waistline. Gives that runner a chance to break.
than yards after catch.
Almost gave that one up.
Yeah, the football looked like the knee was down first, and the ball did come out after he hit the ground. So, point is into Furman territory. An impressive opening drive from the Skyhawks, and Furman will have none of that. Quickly into the backfield to make the play. Donovan Perryman, the senior captain, a preseason OSOCON selection, and Perryman's had quite a career here at Furman. He's got 59 tackles this season. Gets in there for a tackle for loss.
He's had an outstanding senior year. He's a leader, too. He's one of those guys that the rest of the ball club looks to, especially when things are going against you a little bit. You need somebody to pick you up. He's one of them.
From the shotgun on second and 10, go with the power back between the tackles. Tyreek Robinson. Guess where he's from? He's from Georgia. You know, there's a lot of great football, high school football in Georgia. And there are a lot there, and there are a lot of college programs in Georgia, but Point really thrives being in the soul of football country. I mean, you're on the Alabama-Georgia border. That's about as good as it gets when it comes to high school football and college football. So Julius Dixon has some recruiting advantages, if you will, by being in that area. He's got a lot of competition, but there's also a lot of outstanding young men and young football players in that area.
You know, I played my high school football in Atlanta, Georgia.
You set
North
the tone.
Fulton High School. We won the upper state all 3 years I was on the varsity. I'll tell you how we did in the state in a minute.
Trick play. Doesn't work. And the ball comes free. It appeared the runner was down. They did blow the whistle. DeMarcus Clay, number 20 there for Furman.
Good ball handling that time. It takes a lot of confidence in your running backs and wide receivers being able to negotiate a handoff.
But you love the play call, right? Points coming up here, massive underdogs. Have some fun. Loosen things up. Try and make a play.
Absolutely. You got to take your shots if you're the underdog like they are. And there's nothing to be ashamed of. There you are. You're taking them on.
And I love the play of DeMarcus Clay. He switched from cornerback to safety at the beginning of the season, and you can see with a tackle like that why the coaching staff thinks he can play safety in the SoCon. He's had a terrific year, and he's an outstanding tackler.
High snap almost got away from the punter, but he gets one off down inside the 15, and it ain't going to stay inside the 15, though.
Callie Chizik up the right sideline. Terrific return all the way into Point territory. So Callie Chizik, who's really stepped up his special teams play the past couple of weeks, turns this punt into a big play for Furman. Pallet is in great field position, leading 7-0.
And up, down, jumping jacks again. Go up. Don't forget to breathe.
Your granddaughter bought you a new car?
Hey, Gigi, check it out.
Oh, this kid gets me.
And there's a hot tub in the back.
Come on in, ladies. Water aerobics with these guys.
Have mercy.
Your life could be exciting enough. If not, play Powerball.
Four, is that what you said?
Yeah. Back in Greenville, South Carolina, Furman scored a touchdown on their opening drive. Drive number two starts at the 43-yard line, and they will throw. Darren Granger under pressure and goes down. So Granger sacked near midfield. Cameron Weems, the junior from Griffin, Georgia, and Spalding High School, gets in there and makes the play for point.
Got to feel that one coming. That was a late rush. He was involved in a stunt, and it took him some time to get past that line of scrimmage, but I don't think Granger ever really felt him coming. Looked like he was not avoiding him at all, just tucking that ball away and taking the sack.
Always good to avoid a turnover on first down. It'll give yourself some life here on second. Collision in the backfield on a play that was set up for Thomas Gordon, it appears, but now Granger's going to have to run, makes a nifty little move to avoid a loss and picks up five. And this was the type of thing, I think, why Clay Hendricks wants to play this football game and not have a bye week. You don't want to make these type of timing mistakes next week.
Exactly. And he would like to get some extra work in for Darren Granger, who has not started the last couple of games. Camp Sisson has and done a good job. But they need two quarterbacks. You can't go into the playoffs with one of them and nobody ready to play as a starter in case an injury happens during the game.
So a rare third down and long. Third and 12. Pressure from the outside. Granger steps up. Has a lot of green. Darren Granger. Close to the first down. Maybe a yard or two shy. And it may be early decision time for Clay Hendricks and his coaching staff as it's going to be a fourth and two from the 35.
I'm guessing they go for it here. It's actually would be interesting to see Atkins try. It'd be a 56, 57-yard attempt if he did. They're going to go for it.
Paladins line up like they're going to go for it. Of course, when you've got Devin Wynn, a 1,000-yard rusher, and also a comp performer behind an offensive line that's been moving people around, it doesn't seem like so much of a gamble, especially at the 35-yard line. Old-fashioned I formation. They'll try the right side. Devin Wynn, first down Furman, down to the 30-yard line.
Not a hard call to make right there. You're early in the game like this. You want to establish the fact that you are the best team, even though you've gotten the reputation of being a good team. Furman, of course, who picked second in the SoCon behind Wofford in preseason by the coaches. So everybody knew they were going to have a good football team this year.
Furman's two conference losses coming to in-state schools, the Citadel and Wofford. Run the fullback, Devin Abrams. Abrams picks up about three. You know, use of the fullback is something that the coaching staff at Furman has said will be a priority in 2019, and it has been. They've gotten Abrams the ball more, and he's produced. And not only can he produce the power yards, he has some breakaway speed. Had that 69-yarder earlier this year, and they say simply, let's get the fullback the ball, let's use him, and they have this year. And the fullback can be a weapon, even though it's not real hip these days.
Absolutely. All of them coming back. All their running backs are coming back next year.
So is Granger, the quarterback, who makes a throw complete. Thomas Gordon close to a first down, and Thomas Gordon getting closer to making a little bit of history. He's trying to become the all-time leader in career yards receiving. He's got 2,476, so he's getting awfully close to getting to the leader, who is Adam Mims, who has 2,433. Coach will be doing that math throughout the ballgame. Granger rolls. Throws to the end zone. Caught. Touchdown, Paladins. Ryan DeLuca. Great catch by DeLuca to keep the feet in bounds on a slippery football.
Absolutely. That is hand and eye coordination right away. And when a receiver catches that one, I always say, man, they didn't catch it in the hands. He caught it in the fingertips of his hand, and the ball got big once it arrives. Terrific throw, though, making sure this one's out of range of an interception or a knockdown. And at the other end, DeLuca is ready for it.
DeLuca's fourth touchdown of the season. He had four last year. And you talk about getting confidence back as a quarterback. Well, Darren Granger, go look at that film. That was a confident throw and a good throw, well-placed throw.
It was. I think that's an important point you're making right there. He needed to get that confidence back, and those kind of throws will do it.
Emory Bryant back deep for the Skyhawks, hoping to get a return of the Grayson Atkins kickoff. Paladins up 14-0, Furman scoring on both their opening possessions.
If Atkins kicked this one short, I think they're doing it on purpose. They want him to run it back and maybe not get back to the 25-yard line. Let's see if he does it again. Nope, he's going to get this one out of the end zone.
They are still going to burn. No, a little psych job there. Just kidding. Take the knee. Take it at the 25-yard line. But that shows you the mentality of the Skyhawks. They're here to play. They're not here to take a knee.
Yeah.
They want to go out with guns blazing.
I like that, but I would be real careful about making sure that official knew that you were accepting the touchback. You remember there last year where it was a mistake made where Furman did not call for the fair catch and went down on one knee on the 2-yard line and it cost him a ball game. It can happen. That being a fairly new rule, understandable that it might be misinterpreted sometimes.
Well, Point opened the season against a FCS opponent. They played at Kennesaw State and lost 59-0. They'll wrap up the season by playing an FCS opponent here in Furman. Time to throw for Wise, who doesn't throw wisely. It's picked off. Blackshear has it for the Paladins. He's got a wall of gray in front of him. Touchdown, Furman, pick six. Travis Blackshear.
You know what? He looks like a good running back or a good wide receiver after the catch, but he intercepts that ball.
He's a freshman, a redshirt freshman. The coaching staff loves him, and Coach, you are dead on, because back at Benedict Military State in Savannah, he was a track guy. And you could see the track speed right here. Instantly turns it into offense.
Yep. He's passing up some would-be blockers. Just getting right on in that end zone. But that's good reading of the momentum of the tacklers there. Which way are they going to take? And you go the other way at full speed.
Second interception of the season. Had one against Virginia Tech up there in Blacksburg. And the coaching staff very high on Blackshear. Love him on a corner. When you've got confidence in a corner, that opens up the entire defense to allow him to be on an island and allow others to make moves. So Clay Hendricks getting exactly what he wants out of this final week of the regular season. The offense has looked sharp. Granger's gaining confidence at quarterback, and his defense has stepped it up.
Yep, and you can see in his face as he cheers on the sideline there, Coach Clay Hendricks is feeling good about the decisions that are being made out there on the field by these guys. Even though they're playing an NAIA team, they still have to make football decisions on the move.
Yeah, and Coach Hendricks said, you know what, I'm happy where we are, he said. I'm happy that we're getting ready to go into the playoffs, but we didn't live up to our standards, and that standard was a SoCon title. But he, mentally, is still able to go, we could still capture the big prize. I mean, do you think there are teams out there that want to play Furman in the first round or the next round of the playoffs?
I will bet you there's some that don't want to.
I guarantee you that.
And they certainly wouldn't want to on the first round if Furman is playing at home. There is an advantage to that.
Bids go out tomorrow at 12:30. Once the bids are out, we'll determine who is going to host the game. Furman certainly will put in a bid to be a host. And there's still a lot of shuffling that needs to go on to determine the seeds and who's getting into the top eight. And heck, Furman still possibly could get a share of the SoCon title. Now, Wofford would have to lose this afternoon in the Citadel. But there's no rain in Charleston, by the way. It's beautiful down there, and Wofford jumped out to a 14-0 lead. So Wofford looks like they're in a little bit of cruise control on their way to an outright title. Wofford still gets the automatic bid, but it's kind of reversed from last year where these Furman Paladins got a share of the SoCon title but didn't get into the postseason. This year, no SoCon title, but the playoff berth, which may be better.
Could work out for them.
Inside handoff, pits up six on first down. And that's the first time we get to see number one tote the rock. And he's a good one. Averages about 54 yards a game as Jackson out of Lawrenceville, Georgia. Last week he had 86 yards and a touchdown, one of his better games for the season. All-conference performer playing in his 31st game for Point.
Point using the no-huddle style of offense. They don't go back in the huddle. They're not in a hurry out. They're just all at the line of scrimmage, close to where they could at a command get the ball off real quick if they needed to.
Jackson, nowhere to go. Well, we mentioned on the previous possession that Point really needs to take care of the football. That if you're going to pull the upset, you can't make mistakes. And you can't make a bigger mistake than a pick six.
So that's one mistake they've already made. Another one would be if they were to fumble or give up the ball right down here, because not only are you giving up the ball, you're giving up field position. It backed up a little bit because they came out with the ball. They could have touched, you know, got down on one knee, and Fair caught that one and get it on the 25. But chose to take a chance to make the big return, and it didn't happen.
It's third down. Again, that controlled rollout under pressure and goes down. You call that a team stack. There are five Paladins all over the quarterback.
Not only that, they had every receiver downfield locked up. There was nowhere to throw the ball if he did get a good, clean release outside.
I think they'll give Chizik credit for the sack, which will be his first as a Furman Paladin coming off the edge.
Furman this particular series right here shows their dominance. It really, in just about every respect, stopping the run, stopping the pass, and sacking the quarterback.
We talk a lot about seniors here, the final regular season home game, but it's youngsters. Chizik, as you just saw, make the play, and in a return game, and Travis Blackshear, redshirt freshman. Furman has a very young, talented football team.
They do. We go a little bit later on, maybe we'll talk about exactly how many returners, and in another way of saying it, how many guys do they lose this year that are important to the team? The number is not real big. They got a bulk of their team coming back.
Well, Julius Dixon trying to build a tradition at point. He's a former Paladin standout. He's a terrific player, played with Coach Clay Hendricks, of course, when they were here on campus. He was the captain of a championship football team. Nobody ever take that away from you. And not only that, he's just a fun guy to be around and has great pride in being a Furman Paladin, and now he's bringing that to point.
And you've got players that know his history, know it, and respect the way he operates within the football team right there. You can see he's constantly involved in telling players what to do. It's not handed off to assistant coaches. And here's the run back.
Another one from Chizik. He had a 60-plus yard return that set the Paladins up for their second touchdown. And now Furman in great field position again, trying to get their fourth score in the first quarter. And, you know, going back to Coach Dixon, too, when Furman desperately wanted to have a game this week, they want to get the seniors another home game. You want to get prepared for the playoffs. Point had to jump through some hoops as an NAIA school to come up here and play. Coach Dixon did that for him.
Yeah. Well, that speaks highly of the relationship that the two, that Hendricks and Dixon have, and the respect that they have for each other.
Ham Sisson in at quarterback will hand it off to Devin Wynn. Wynn with a stiff arm gets outside. Actually got brought down by his own player there as he picks up 3 yards. So Hamp Sisson into the ball game for Furman. Sisson started the past couple of games. Granger started today, and Sisson gets some action, and we expect to see even more rotation of players coming in and out throughout the ball game. But important to get Sisson back in the groove too.
Yeah. Want everybody sharp for next week. And chances are Furman's going to be playing next week. They won't be getting the bye.
I'm pretty sure. Yeah, they're going to play next week. It's a matter of where and who. Sisson will throw on second down. Throwing for Thomas Gordon. Gordon almost makes the grab. Could have been a historic touchdown for Gordon as he could have became the all-time leading receiver as far as yardage goes with a dramatic touchdown, but it got knocked away at the last second. Gordon,
Yeah, take a close look at the release. He's got the position. Ball is thrown to the outside, but not far enough to the outside. Good coverage that time.
So they're trying to get Thomas Gordon a couple of touches here, possibly, to get him to that record. Playing his final regular season home game. He has been a playmaker since he walked on the campus 4.5 years ago. Run it up the middle. And come close to a first down. Devin Wynn's last second surge may have put it right on the marker.
Get up, Devin Wynn. They need you next week. He got popped pretty good there. The last guy in was coming full speed. I didn't catch the number, but it was a defensive back, and linebackers had him pretty well stacked up, and it looks like he's okay.
Well, the last time we were here at Paladin Stadium, Furman was taking on VMI, and Devin Wynn had a 5-touchdown performance, 4 rushing, 1 catching out of the backfield. Second time they'll go for it on fourth down. They're 1-for-1 on fourth down conversions. Wynn is the lone setback behind Sisson. Anderson goes in motion. Give it to Wynn, but a flag flies. There was some movement along the line of scrimmage, so hold on to everything.
Well, they're clearly within Atkins' range if they choose to go for the field goal. This will be a 5-yard penalty. No, they're calling this offside.
Offside on the defense number 42, 5-yard penalty, first down.
The difference there, of course, is if the defense comes across the line during the snap or lines up in the neutral zone, it's offside.
It was the left end 42 with the long hair flowing, so you can't quite see the number. He lined up offsides. So there's Hamp Sisson out of Birmingham, Alabama. He's thrown for 489 yards this year, 3 touchdowns, 2 interceptions. He rolls on first down and throws out complete on the little out pattern to Thomas Gordon.
Thomas Gordon still building those numbers, though, getting close to a record catch in terms of yards, receiving yards. Climbing up in front of a couple of guys who are in front of him. He's only got a couple of guys, though, in front of him.
It looked like he wanted to grab the football, so maybe he knows he may have broken the record with that catch. We're doing the math. If so, congratulations to Thomas Gordon. He comes out of the game on second down and short. Gets hugs on the sideline. Thomas Gordon, all-time leader for the Furman Paladins in reception yardage. Second down and a few, but really it's a goal line situation. They give it back to Devin Wynn. Wynn gets a block from Abrams, but then gets piled up at the 4-yard line. So that'll be the final play of the first quarter, a first quarter in which the Paladins hang 21 points up on the board, and Thomas Gordon makes history. With that catch, he is the all-time leading receiver yardage-wise in Furman University history. Congratulations to Thomas Gordon. That is an impressive list. When you move past the Sims and the Suttles, you know you've had a great career. Congratulations, Thomas Gordon, all-time leading receiver yardage-wise in the history of Furman. And that will end the first quarter. We'll be back with the second with Furman up 21-0 here in Greenville, South Carolina. Second quarter begins with Furman with a third down and one. Power formation, I formation. Hamp Sisson under center. He will throw but get blindsided and brought down. Point with the pressure from the outside. Gary Davis, the junior from Sandy Creek High School in Georgia, makes the play.
I think that may have been a blown assignment in the blocking and the protection scheme rather than just getting beat because he came absolutely clean. Nobody
second sack of the game. Second sack of the game for Point.
Yeah.
So the Paladins will have to settle for a field goal attempt, and that means Grayson Atkins, the all-SoCon kicker, who's going to be quite a weapon for Furman in the postseason.
Been quite a weapon at Furman in the regular season.
No doubt about it.
He's something special.
27-yarder is up, and it is good. So Grayson Atkins delivers again. He now is 10 of 11 in field goals this season as the Furman Paladins celebrate a big lead, and they celebrate their teammate Thomas Gordon becoming the team's all-time leading receiver.
Something brought us here, to a time and a place where your decisions can actually drive change. Where extra achievers become ultra-curricular. Where a private institution serves a greater public mission. At Furman University, opportunity is all around you. So take our commitment, combine it with everything you're capable of, and the world will be forced to take notice.
Furman's conference season is over. This game today, of course, a non-conference game. The Paladins finished 6-2 in the Southern Conference, losing to Wofford last week. They still could get a share of the conference title, but Wofford is down at the Citadel this afternoon, and Wofford's up early on the Citadel, so it looks like the Terriers are heading towards a 7-1 finish and an outright conference championship. Terriers already have the automatic bid into the postseason, but the Furman Paladins today looking to secure their 8th win of the season. They're up 24-0. They know they'll be in the playoffs next week, and now it's just a matter of finding out who they'll play and where they'll play. The hopes around these parts are that next week, about this time, we'll be kicking off a playoff game. Point will return it. Nowhere to go. Brought down at the 15-yard line. So the Paladins have scored on their first four possessions. Three touchdowns and a field goal. And the defense has done their job as well. I take that back. There actually is a defensive touchdown. So all three offensive possessions they have scored. And they've even scored on defense.
And they're going to be playing a lot of players now for the rest of the way. For your nice little balance here, you want to get your regulars in the ball game so they don't get out of rhythm of the season. At the same time, you don't want to get anybody hurt, so you play the other players. But they get a chance to use some of that hard work they spent on the practice field in a real game.
And it's not mass substitutions where you have first team and second team. They start to intermingle players. So you'll see a Brian Okay and a DeMarcus Clay out there being the secure guys at safety. They're the starters, but you're seeing some linebackers. You're seeing some new different players come into the ballgame. So they'll intertwine. Absolutely. New quarterback for Point. We mentioned how they'll use the two-quarterback system. Keenan Wise played the entire first quarter. Micah Mackey comes in here for the second. Mackey has passed for more than 1,100 yards this season, 9 touchdowns, 5 interceptions, got 3 rushing touchdowns. Last week against Bluefield, he played very well in a win last week against Bluefield. He threw for 112 yards and a touchdown.
And a little early movement by the running backs. Actually, every one of them moved, I think, prior to the snap.
Well, that's a different quarterback sometimes, right? And everybody's a little off rhythm.
Everybody is. Everybody but the center. And he's the guy with the ball until he snaps it back to that quarterback.
Well, Point definitely doesn't want to play behind the chains, but here they are in second down and 15.
Yep.
And Point's had a hard time protecting the quarterback. The one thing that's made it difficult for Maxie, I think, who's played pretty well this year at quarterback, he's been sacked 26 times. Make it 27.
Way to count up to the high water mark right there, just in time.
Landon Lawrence got him for the Furman Paladins.
Good shot, Nate. It was both backs cross in front of him, but neither one picks up the rusher coming from the outside. And Furman's defense is quick, and they're fast. And they all have some experience during the course of the season because Furman's had some good steady leads and gotten some of these younger guys playing not just today but going into today.
Dangerous situation for Point. They'll throw out of their own end zone. That's a lateral. That ball is free. Paladins pick it up, and they take it in for the touchdown. I'll tell you, if you watch it on the replay, they should never have blown the whistle. That did not look like a forward pass, but they are going to blow it dead. And Jordan Willis, a senior, thought he had a touchdown in his final regular season home game, and so did I. That's a break for Point. Take a look.
Well, they will rule inadvertent whistle. We'll take another look at it here in a second, but they'll rule inadvertent whistle at worst. Here's the throw. It is a lateral, no question. It is a live ball, but you see the official out there calling it dead, which takes precedent over what we think up here in the booth.
It was close. It was close, but it did look like a lateral in live play, and certainly Willis thought it was. They have to punt from the back of the end zone. Don't want to step backwards, and they do. There's 2 points for the Furman Paladins. The snap was a bit high. The football is wet. It's raining. There's no margin for error. And the snap goes out of the back of the end zone. 2 more for Furman as they take a 26-0 lead, a special teams mistake from Point. Paladins continue to dominate. And that's the definition of diehard fans. Enjoying a little KC in the Sunshine Band when there's no sunshine. 26-0, Furman has the lead here at Paladin Stadium. Furman's getting production from everybody. They've got a pick six for a touchdown, so the defense has scored. They've got a special teams field goal. They've got a special teams safety and a couple touchdowns a more conventional way on offense. That all adds up to 26-0, and now after the safety point, we'll have to kick it off from the 20, so Paladins will be in good field position again. Wayne Anderson back deep. You want to see some speed? Here you go. Here's Wayne Anderson, former sprinter out of Texas. Gets tripped up as he takes it out to the 42-yard line, and that was close.
One step away. You know, you don't really have to make a clean tackle. You just have to interrupt the stride a little bit when a guy's running full speed.
And Anderson was a young man out of Texas recruited by a lot of the FBS schools. He made the decision to play at the FCS level to come here to Furman. And again, he's just a freshman. We saw last week what he can do with that touchdown run against Wofford. He's rushed for almost 300 yards this season, limited action. A lot of depth at running back for the Furman Paladins. Sisson fumbles. Ball still free, and Anderson will pounce on it. So these are the mistakes that the Paladins want to eliminate. And Sisson couldn't quite get grasp of the football. And you can blame what football a lot, but at some point you got to make those adjustments.
Well, the ball, when they lay that ball down, the laces are up, and on the bottom, the same spot gets wet over and over again if they don't change the ball, you know, regularly. And the ball can get very slick, especially when you're under center. You're better off actually taking a shotgun snap because you've got a chance to grab a lot of different spots on the ball. But once you've got your thumb on that wet spot and you try to put it, give it on a pitch or a pass, it can be a real problem, especially on a day like today when really it's not pouring down rain and so everybody's wet in the same. It's a dry ball with a wet spot on it and makes it tough to handle.
To change the weight of the football? Change the balance of the football? When
I don't think so. Never thought about that, but I don't think so. I think all it does is the grip.
Blitz from the corner. Sisson steps up in the pocket, slings it to Thomas Gordon, who adds to his record-breaking day. Thomas Gordon gets to the corner. The senior down inside the 20, knocked out around the 16-yard line.
Wow, boy, you talk about a selfish guy. He wants even more yards.
Yards after the catch, too, and Sisson stood in the pocket, made a perfect throw. Full hands extended, made the catch.
Beautiful. You know, the little sidebar here is we have two quarterbacks today that have played very well. They have put the ball right where it belongs. And those receivers are making the great catches, too.
Thomas Gordon's 44th game as a Furman Paladin. Sisson on the option. Pitches it out to Devin Wynn. Wynn cuts back and walks it in for another Furman Paladin touchdown.
You get Devin Wynn in the open like that where he's got room to cut left and right, he's going to win most of those battles. And he did again just right there. Boy, is he a special runner.
And acknowledge that Hamp Sisson, after fumbling the football, coming from out of center on the first play of the game, doesn't panic, doesn't get down on himself, doesn't try and do too much. Instead, on third down, makes a perfect throw to Thomas Gordon, then makes the proper decision to pitch here to set up Wynn for the touchdown. Yeah. Grayson Atkins gets the point after, and the Paladins are rolling. Final regular season game of 2019, and the Paladins are primed for the playoffs. Devin Wynn and Furman have rushed out to a 33-0 lead. Yes, sir. Grab a quick drink, hang on. Well, the Furman Paladins certainly were the favorites to get the job done today against Point. And you'll see around the league in the Southern Conference, a lot of SoCon teams stepping up to play the big boys. Western Carolina struggling down at Tuscaloosa right now, taking on Alabama. Samford stays in their state, and they take on Auburn. The key game is Wofford playing at the Citadel. The Terriers lead 21-0 down at the Citadel. And so it appears that Wofford is indeed on their way to an outright SoCon championship. And we'll go back to that graphic in a minute as this return comes out past the 35-yard line. But one of the reasons Point is in town today is this is a week where normally the FCS schools play an FBS team.
Yeah.
And Furman played there too earlier in the season, but you saw a lot of SoCon teams playing SEC teams. This is usually the week that happens. So when the scheduling worked out to where the Furman Paladins were left with a bye week for the last week of the season, that's where Point came into play.
And the relationship with the two coaches having played at Furman in their playing days, really kind of doing a favor for Furman to step in here and play at this late part of the season. And knowing that they weren't going to, you know, have much of a chance to beat Furman, but
you show up and you do your best, try and get it to the outside and make a play on the corner.
Yep.
And it's just relentless pursuit from the Paladins, and eventually they are able to bring down Ty Robinson.
Actually, he made a terrific run, but it was lateral. It wasn't going. Yeah,
there's about 25 yards worth of running, but none of it counts as in the stats as he went sideways most of the way.
Yeah.
Braden Gilby there to make the stop, 43. Another young player, a redshirt freshman. Gilby really jumped into the starting lineup. He's one of the leaders in tackling on this team. That's his 66th tackle of the season, his fourth tackle for loss. And Gilby, 43 for the Paladins, had that huge game up against Virginia Tech. So we talk about the youth on offense. It's on defense as well. Try to set up a screen. Nifty little move. Gets it out close to the first down, or back to the original line of scrimmage, I should say.
Right. You know, you're talking about the mismatches and so forth. Furman really hasn't played the bigger school, Virginia Tech, Georgia State, I suppose. We'd have to count them. They beat Tennessee the week before we played them. They went out there and lost in a 48-42 game to Georgia State. And Virginia Tech had them at halftime. I think it was like 20-3 or something, wasn't it?
Yeah, Paladins led in both ball games.
Yeah, they had to have time. They were
in
ahead.
Both ball games.
It's a they're very competitive with bigger schools.
Maxey takes it inside the 40 out to the 43-yard line, setting up a fourth down and about three. And looks like Point will go ahead and punt the football away.
You know, we're talking about being competitive. In the preseason, the coaches and the media both picked Furman and Wofford to be the two probably dominant schools in the SoCon this year, which they have been, and playing against each other. At Wofford, Wofford played the better game. They deserve to win. But Furman certainly is capable of winning big games like that. And this is probably going to set them up for that. Woo!
A lot of pressure, and they get a piece of the football. So it's a partial block, and the ball will eventually roll down around the 30-yard line. So the Paladins special teams making their third splash play of the football game.
Yep, and for those that don't follow the rules too closely, what's that? Ball is touched by a rusher, there is no more roughing the kicker penalty if you get a hand on the football, which obviously they did the way that ball came off his foot.
Well, Coach, you had a very interesting question as we chatted in between commercials on whether or not Darren Granger would return to the Furman lineup to get some reps after having such an impressive start. You said yes, I said no. As always, you are correct. Is Darren Granger back in the football game?
No, it's not really always I'm correct. Just you're always wrong. Oh, but okay. We'll just go into that later.
Granger had a terrific first quarter as he ran for a touchdown and threw for another. But he's greeted rudely here in the second and loses five on first down.
The microphone of the Furman guys got a little bit roughed up on that one.
As Jacob Johanning, he appears to be okay. Number 57, by the way, now starting or into the lineup here. One of those freshmen, local guy, went to St. Joe's Catholic High School here in Greenville, South Carolina. He's been on the depth chart, and he's been earning some playing time. He just hasn't had a chance to get it because the offensive line's been so good, and the offensive line now can't do much about that as the running back fumbles the football. Point thinks they have it.
Ball was fumbled on the pitch or the exchange, and Point does have it.
So the Paladins, who had played a crisp and clean football game up to that point, put it on the turf, and this time they don't get it back. See Granger with a pitch that just didn't come out right. And there's no way for Wayne Anderson to handle that short hop, and eventually Point pounces on it.
I don't know if the ball's wet or whatever, but he lost the ball in the run before he was ready to pitch it. However, here's the good side. Now they get to practice goal line or inside the red zone defense.
You wouldn't be saying that if you were the coach.
No.
It's easy to
say. I don't want him to know I said it.
Best field position of the game, obviously, for Point under pressure. Maxie gets it away. And the Paladins swarm under, but still able to pick up 5 yards. A nifty little spin at the last second there from Emery Bryant. Bryant's done a good job on returns this game, on kickoff returns, and now turns a negative play into a positive for the Skyhawks.
Well, that gives them something to talk about at practice next week is getting those second and third tacklers in there to help out, and number one tackler, making sure that you don't let go of that grip.
Maxie rolls and throws towards the end zone. Caught for a touchdown. Point is on the board. A one-handed grab from the freshman, Jacob Gamble. He's 6'5", 235 pounds. Had a couple of catches last week. This, his second touchdown of the season. Beautiful grab.
Great catch. Two defenders right around him.
And he's so casual about it. I wasn't sure he made the grab at first, but he just put that big right hand out there and swallowed that football.
Oh, ball fell just in out of range of the defenders. Good throw, good catch.
So Point turns the turnover into a touchdown. And the kick is up and good. So Point on the board. That can't make Clay Hendricks happy. But when you look at the resume and all he's accomplished here over the last 3 years, I mean, you talk about raising the bar. He showed up in town talking SoCon Championship because he's been involved in 9 SoCon Championships as a player or a coach here at Furman. None as a head coach right now except for the shared one last year. But look at what he's done in his first 3 years. 2017, made the playoffs and won a playoff game. Last year, share the SoCon title. This year, they'll head to the playoffs again.
And he's put together a staff, a strong, strong staff, many of whom are going to be talk to his future head coaches themselves, and all of those guys along with him are responsible for recruiting these players. You've got to get good football players. Players play the game. Coaches, of course, get them ready, but the players have to play the game, and that's where a coach comes into play again, and that is the recruitment to come to a school like Furman and got potential, convince the player and the mom and the dad this is home for you, and he's certainly done a great job of that.
And he's done a great job of with the seniors as well. Onside kick. We thought this might be coming. Going towards out of bounds. And the Paladins wisely do knock it away.
Yeah.
And again, Point has come to play. They may call that an illegal touch as the penalty flag comes flying in or an illegal batting it out of bounds. Either way, it's going to be Furman football.
I'm an illegal touch.
I'm not sure what that could be for.
I don't know if that's an illegal touch. I mean, you're receiving the ball.
Well, I'm not sure if Point maybe got a piece of that first and maybe what the flag is. But we'll see. Maybe they were just marking where it went out of bounds and he didn't have anything else to throw.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's against Point.
Okay.
I think they got a piece of it.
All right. Furman will take it right there. They're happy with the field position from the 40-yard line or roughly the 40.
Well, Clay Hendricks said this week, hey, he was asked, are you going to just come out here and work on some things? He's like, no, we got a game plan. We're playing this as a straight-up football game. And that's what they've done. I mean, they're not going to change anything now, even though they've given up a score. It's 33-7.
Well, you're rehearsing the playoffs. You don't want to rehearse something you're not going to do in the playoffs.
Yeah,
you want to rehearse exactly the format and the intent and how intense you have to be during practice and pay attention and get the details right. One more rehearsal, and today's the day for that before the playoffs.
Well, the Paladins fumbled on the previous play. That was Darren Granger. He's now out. Hemp Sisson is back in at quarterback for Furman for this possession as the officiating crew gathers to figure out what the call was, why they made it, and why we're standing around in the rain waiting to play football.
The delay is with the stripes. Bob Johnson is the referee. Bob Johnson, and I'm sure it's not the same one. Let's listen to the call.
No flag.
No flag. That's the call it should have been. Bob Johnson was also the number one pick ever for the Cincinnati Bengals in 1968. Played at Tennessee, was an offensive center. And that's not him on this field today. But Bob and I were teammates for years, so his name registered with me.
So Paladins have the ball at the 40-yard line after all that. And they go right up the gut. And right up the gut produces for Furman. Devin Abrams, we talked earlier in the first quarter about how the fullback has become an integral part of this team. And there's a fullback with another long run. He had a 69-yarder earlier this year. This one gets him into the 40s. A 40-yard-plus run for a fullback, Devin Abrams.
Kevin, and he's a redshirt freshman. There's a lot of young talent on this team, and this is a step towards a conference championship down the road. I just can't see this team getting anything but better.
Sisson with a late pitch and a good one. First down for Furman for Devin Wynn inside the 15 down to the 13-yard line.
You know, Bob Mahalik, that's your name, right?
Yes, Coach White.
The other little sidebar to all of this is, with all the young players coming back, they're coming back in the same system. This same coaching staff is going to be in place as well.
And I was going to mention something before the onside kick about how the seniors who weren't recruited by this coaching staff have blended in as well. Thomas Gordon's record-breaking receiver wasn't recruited by Clay Hendricks.
Right.
He was recruited by the previous administration, the previous regime, and he's done a great job of blending these student athletes to become one team. And if you didn't get that buy-in from the seniors, you would have struggled. But Coach Hendricks and his staff did a great job of getting the buy-in from the seniors, and I think that is key.
You know, I never heard a rumor even of because of the change in the coaching staff, that anybody wanted out. Any of the players wanted to go somewhere else rather than be here. They bought right in because once they met Coach Clay Hendricks and the rest of the staff that was going to be here, he said, this is where I'd like to be. Players did.
Sisson throws underneath. There's a flag down. Roberto takes the reception out, picks up about 4 or 5 yards.
Gets back to the original spot, maybe a yard beyond it. Original spot of the first down marker.
To the penalty against Point.
And
lined up, I believe, in the neutral zone.
Must have been something prior to the snap like that, lining up in the neutral zone's most likely call.
Furman Paladins, the best red zone team in the conference, one of the best in the nation, and that's what made last week so frustrating, is a couple of times last week down inside the 5-yard line, they couldn't punch it in against the Wofford Terriers. But they have been incredibly efficient at a better than a 90% rate of scoring, and really the touchdown rate's remarkable for Furman in the red zone. They're looking for another. Sisson keeps it and gets down to the 5-yard line, close to a first down.
Looked a little bit like Darren Granger right there running the ball, too. Not quite as tall as Granger. Certainly a solid, solid quarterback. Great high school career.
Yeah, out of Birmingham, Alabama, more than 5,000 yards passing in his high school career. Again, a very competitive high school region. So it's third down and one from the 5. A lot of movement, Point jumps. It appears to be on the Skyhawks.
Usually, if it's the offense, they come in rolling those hands, those forearms, as if illegal procedure. But this is a defensive penalty right there. The defense jumps offsides.
And the man that jumped offsides is the man closest to the football.
Yep. That's the voice of the quarterback. Here's how the quarterback does it. He throws that second hut, you know, ready, set, hut, hut. He throws it an octave up, ready, set, hut, hut. And then the next snap is the real snap. Next call is a real snap, and the defense doesn't know what to do.
You know, I think I jumped upside when you gave that hut there.
Yeah, you flinched.
Threw me off. That fleeky had me flinching here in the booth. Point comes up with a defensive stop on first down, though, as Anderson was looking for the touchdown, but gets clipped down and loses a yard on the play.
Point is still playing hard football. They're still playing best they can. They've turned that ball over or given field position once or twice in this ball game, but the rest of the time it's been mano a mano. They're going to get their guy off. It looks like Furman's going to allow that to happen.
Second and goal. Abrams is the lone back. Abrams gets the ball and goes nowhere, loses a yard. So Point with a little goal line stand here, moving Furman backwards on the last two plays.
And as you mentioned earlier here, they're moving one of the best team, the best team in the SoCon in red zone scoring. Now, when we say red zone scoring, we're talking about touchdowns and field goals.
Right.
Now this decision by the officials. They're keeping it a secret again.
Well, they're going to let him play here on third down and goals. The rain falling down harder here at Paladin Stadium. Lights on a damp, dreary day, but the Paladins looking to score again. Short side option. Wayne Anderson. Touchdown, Furman. So another touchdown for Anderson. And the Paladins now feel extra point away from making it 40 in the first half.
You know, Anderson could feel that he had room to score right about now, about the 5 yard line, 4.5, 5 yard line. He doesn't actually accelerate, he kind of cruises on in for the touchdown. That's a guy that really understands where he is on the field.
Zach Peterson made a good block for him. A wide receiver, a freshman, was in the ball game. Point after is good, and Furman has 40 on the board as they lead Point 40-7. So it's been far from perfect. Furman has put the ball on the turf a couple of times, but when you put 40 points up, you're feeling pretty good about yourself. We're about 2 minutes and 22 seconds away from halftime at the half. We'll take a look around the SoCon and take a look at some of the highlights from the previous week. We'll take a look at the highlights from the first half and go through the stats. I'll give you a clue. They will show Furman dominating this football game. And there is your fan of the week. I told you the rain was coming down. It stopped for a while, but it is coming down hard and heavy. There he is.
Yeah,
give us a wave.
Spot it. And wearing the Furman colors, too, purple and white. Actually, he looks very comfortable and warm there, too. I think he's padded up pretty good.
Nothing but smiles on that Furman sideline as well. They will return it from 3 yards deep in the end zone and won't get it out to the 15.
You know, Atkins, the weather being the way it is, I'm not sure if that's affecting the seat. That would affect the football, probably not carrying as far.
Well, the amazing thing is, despite this front, and this is why we've been having rain all day, this front's moving through so slowly, there's not a breath of wind out there. All the flags are dormant. There's no wind whatsoever, just nothing but rain. So the Skyhawks get the football. We'll see if they can put together a two-minute drill. Their touchdown came off of a Paladin turnover. It was only an 18-yard drive, but a successful one at that. And our camera crew right on it. You can see the trees changing colors. Usually when that beautiful blue sky is out there, this is just a great setting for college football.
You sound like a weatherman retiring after 40 or 50 years in the service here. And we've got one in Greenville, South Carolina.
We did. That was not my John Sesserich impression, I promise you. But it is interesting that this front is so slow-moving that it rains the whole time, but there's no wind behind it.
No.
Just point that out. I'm sure there's some science behind that.
I feel like I know more than I came with.
I feel that every time I sit next to you, of course, as we leave here. But so as Furman and Point play out this football game, what is Point trying to accomplish the rest of the way, and what is Furman trying to accomplish the rest of the way?
Point would like, obviously, to score another, be able to say that they put a couple of touchdowns, two or three touchdowns. If they got a whole half ahead of them here, 2 minutes, 17 left in the first half. But Furman wants to be solid. They just want to feel like, even though we play some backup players in the game, we stayed solid. We stayed with the game plan that we had to begin with. Part of this game, you know, is mental. It's not all physical. And we're looking at the fans look at the physical part of it, but there's a large part of it that's mental, being in the right place at the right time.
Cameron Coleman made the stop. The nose guard, another freshman, getting some playing time for the Furman Paladins.
Big deal for a young player to get in, too. Breaking, you know, they practice. They put in all the same hours that the starters have put in, but they don't get to celebrate on game day. But in games like this, when there is a wide margin and room for the starters to sit down, take a little bit of a break.
Yeah, and you got decisions to make because there's the redshirt rule if you play four games, but a lot of these players haven't had a chance to play much at all. So
right.
if you haven't played yet or you've only played in one or two games, you can get some playing time today, and still, if the coaching staff determines you can be redshirted in the future. Wise will keep it and get back to the original line of scrimmage.
By the way, that is a good rule, the good rule that was put into play, the four games rule, so that you can actually step out there on the football field, get a little bit of work, be a part of the team, and still have your 4 years left of eligibility. Used to, you know, you step foot on that, you play one play, you were out for the year. That year counted against your scholarship. So this is a much better rule. Four games is a nice number.
Keep an eye on number 81 in gray and purple at the top of the screen. Adrian Hope in the ball game. And they won't pass with Hope on the corner. They'll decide to run it up the middle on third down and short. And pick up third down and long and pick up a short yard. Sets up fourth down and five.
Another good defensive stop by the Paladins.
Well, it's an interesting call from Coach Dixon, because this is a point team that has tried an onside kick. It's done a flea flicker, and yet on third down and eight, they decide they're just going to run the football up the middle here in the final 2 minutes.
Well, that actually is an unexpected call. You'd expect maybe some kind of a pass or an option where you can get outside if they stop you inside.
And they may have noticed what I was noticing, too, that Hope comes back into the game, and they had their best rushers, the Furman Paladins did. Yep. Their best pass rushers were on the field, and they were coming from the edge. And so the point offensive team up in the booth probably saw that and determined that maybe a draw up the middle was the proper play.
Right. Sounds good to me.
Sure, we'll go with that. Chizik back deep, takes it at about the 50. Callie Chizik. Goes down at the 46-yard line.
One too many stagger steps. Is there a flag on the play? There is a flag on the play. I think there may have been a face mask in that tackle, involved in that tackle. Let's see.
Good call, Coach. Face mask on point.
That's a big one, too. That's 15 yards, I believe. Let's see how they call it. His head did snap down at the tackle. Like that.
He's got the back of the helmet as well.
Yeah.
Well, usually when your special teams return man is zigging and zagging, that just sets you up for a clip or block in the back and usually hurts the offense. This time it hurts the defense, so the right. Paladins now can work on their two-minute drill. They've got 1 minute, 11 seconds, and the ball in good field position at the 31-yard line.
Certainly in Atkins, our field goal kicker, their field goal kicker.
Granger, deep down the middle, just short. Did he grab it? No, incomplete. It skipped on the turf. Intended receiver was Thomas Gordon.
Underthrown just a little bit. Gordon tried to make the turn back in there, but his momentum is just taking him too far into the end zone to be able to come back for it.
He had two steps on the defender.
Oh.
Ball was just short-armed.
Mm-hmm.
Darren Granger back in at quarterback. There's Thomas Gordon, who became the all-time leading receiver in Furman history yardage-wise in the second quarter. And a little 7-yard out pattern put him over the top.
All spread out in formation.
Option. Granger keeps. Seven Skyhawks jump on the Furman quarterback and keep him to a 3-yard gain. And Furman calls a quick timeout with 56 seconds left.
Well, Furman has his third down, and then on fourth down, they are clearly, unless, of course, they take a big sack or something, they're in field goal range. Probably wouldn't hurt Atkins to step out there and pop one through from about 45 or 50 yards. And
he's 5 of 6 from that range this season.
Yep. Keep his reputation going. It's not a string. It's a reputation nowadays. Everybody in the Southern Conference knows what kind of a kicker Furman has.
Well, we mentioned this last week, and I'm certainly no pro scout here, but he appears to have an NFL caliber leg.
No question about
that. He could kick anywhere in the nation right now on the college level. That's the one thing that's pretty even throughout all the levels of football. That goalpost is the same at every stadium. Granger throws complete. No, dropped. He hit Gordon right between the numbers. You won't see that very often as Granger drops a sure thing.
Yep. That was a solid throw right into the bread basket.
I think it may have caught the face mask before he was able to pull it into his chest.
You know, if you let the ball get to your chest, sometimes it's called the trampoline effect. It just bounces off that shoulder pad and that lays down over your sternum, and you can't hold on to it. It just goes anywhere it wants to go.
Point calls a timeout before Grayson Atkins puts toe to leather. It would have been no good.
Thank you, Point, from the Furman standpoint.
Well, the whistle blew, and Atkins knew it. He laid off of that one a little bit, sort of like a knockdown tee shot. He didn't quite swing it through. But there's Grayson Atkins out of Spartanburg County, nearby here to Greenville. Played his high school ball at Chapman, not so far away. And he has been a terrific weapon for the Paladins. He already has a field goal here today. He's missed one field goal this season. And last year, Coach, well, I think one of our favorite moments of the season last year was Atkins, that man right there, number 17, kicking three 50-plus yard field goals in one football game.
Absolutely. And let me tell you, the size of the player, the physique of the player, can the guy kick? Is he accurate kicking the ball? And just not how far, but how accurate he is. And, of course, the farther out you can be accurate, the more valuable you become.
Atkins from 45 yards away. It's good.
It's almost automatic. I hate to say that because there's all kinds of things that can happen. The snap can be off center. The hole can be a little bit off the point, off the spot. But the snap, the hold, and the kick have been beautiful this year.
And as you say that, let's acknowledge a senior playing his final regular season home game, Evan Vaughn, the snapper for the Furman Paladins. When you don't mention snapper's name, that's a good thing, right? Because you usually only mention it when something goes wrong. But Vaughn actually scored on a two-point conversion this year, too. So props to Evan Vaughn, the senior snapper for the Furman Paladins. Yep. Top eight on this list will get the first round bye, you're guessing. They'll figure that out. The rest our playoff teams. Furman, you'll see him right there in the mix on the right-hand column. It's 7-4 between Kennesaw State, Central Connecticut State. So you could pretty much look at that list and go, okay, these teams are in. You got top eight who get a bye. The next 16, you try and pair them up. They will try and pair them up regionally as best as they can. They want it to be a bus trip. Mm-hmm. But if it ceases to be a bus trip, then if you're Furman, you could wind up hosting Yale. You could wind up hosting somebody from the West Coast. So there are a lot of options out there. But it's nice to see the Furman Paladins in the mix for sure. There's a blunder from Point. It's going to cost them almost 2 points. Indecision clouds your vision. And when that ball was rolling, he was waiting for it, Bryant was, to get into the end zone. And then there was that slight panic when it appeared that Furman could pounce on the ball at the 1 or 2 yard line. And he grabs it and almost got tackled for a safety.
Well, at least Brian West understood where he was and what the rules are. He would have been, see him leap out of the end zone right there to make sure he saved the two-point safety.
It looked like it would have gone into the end zone. Had he waited, it would have gone into the end zone and it would have been marked down at the 25. But the only good news for Point is there's 39 seconds left. They're just going to fall on the football anyhow. So take the snap, fall forward, and get into the locker room. Paladins already have one safety on a snap that went over the punter's head. Lunge forward. Keep it out of the end zone.
Not very much, but they don't have to be very much. I don't think Furman will call timeout and try to freeze them back in here. They'll be happy going in with a very large margin. Point able to get 7 points on the board on a great catch by a giant tight end.
Jacob Gamble.
He's a big guy and acted like it was just another day at the office, though, when he made the catch.
Yeah, so Point's one touchdown was a good one, but the Furman Paladins hang 43 points on the board in the first half. Final regular season home game. You think Furman is primed for the playoffs? I would say that first half went pretty well. Furman leads it 43-7. Stay with us. We've got a lot of good stuff at halftime, including a look around the SoCon.
do this or what? You gotta do it. And keep doing it. Do it big. Hit it. Step it up. Always take the risk. Don't just watch it. Put your phone down and do it. Drip splash like the ice on the wrist. That's a call I can't miss. Do what they say you can't. Because there are those who don't and those who do. Let's do.
And up, down, jumping jacks again, go up. Don't forget to breathe.
Your granddaughter bought you a new car?
Hey, Gigi, check it out.
Oh, this kid gets me.
And there's a hot tub in the back.
Come on in, ladies. Water aerobics with these guys.
Have mercy.
Your life could be exciting enough. If not, play Powerball.
Something brought us here, to a time and a place where your decisions can actually drive change. Where extra achievers become ultra-curricular. Where a private institution serves a greater public mission. At Furman University, opportunity is all around you. So take our commitment, combine it with everything you're capable of, and the world will be forced to take notice.
Welcome to Furman University in Greenville, South Carolina. I'm Sarah, and I'm going to take you around to a few spots on campus today to show you what life is like as a Paladin. The JVD Library. We have study rooms for any time, access to all kinds of research, and student tutors for any subject. The library is always busy with students, be it studying in a quiet spot or hanging out on the porch with friends. This is the Trone Student Center, where you can study, watch the game, or just hang out. It also houses our student organizations on campus, like the Furman University Student Activities Board, Student Government Association, and the Heller Service Court. Downstairs, we have the Paladin Food Court and Tupelo Honey Cafe, serving Southern brunch all day long. This is the Dining Hall, or the DH. We have a wide variety of options like a Mongolian grill, locally sourced vegetables, and even a waffle bar. You'll see students in here hanging out, studying, and eating lots of cookies. Town Science Center is one of the main academic buildings on campus and is equipped with state-of-the-art lab technology. Furman's small class size allows students to engage with each other and with their professors for classroom discussion. We're here at the Shy Center for Sustainability, a new building on campus dedicated to educating students about sustainable living. And now, the PAC, the on-campus gym, with cardio machines, weightlifting, a basketball court, and exercise classes offered weekly. There's something here for everybody. Furman is known for our beautiful lake and bell tower. Around the lake is the perfect place to read a book, go for a run, or hammock. On the other side, you can access the Swamp Rabbit Trail, where you can bike, blade, or walk to downtown Greenville or downtown Traveler's Rest. Furman fields 20 Division I athletic teams, including basketball, football, soccer, and even club rugby. If you love sports, we've got games on campus all year long. Whatever it is you like to do, you can find it here at Furman. Come check it out for yourself. Go Dins.
It's time to drop the curtain on the regular season. This is the final week of SoCon Football Weekly, Week 13, around the Southern Conference, and is presented by Catapult.
Let's go ahead and take a look at the updated league standings after the decisive games of 1 week ago. There's still an opportunity for a couple of teams to improve their stock in this final week of the regular season. A pair of teams continue receiving votes in national polls, Chattanooga and the Citadel sharing that distinct honor, while Wofford and Furman remain solidly in the rankings, both landing inside the top 20 heading into this week's action. The Wofford Terriers clinched at least a share of the SoCon title and the league's automatic bid into the FCS playoffs with a home win over upstate rival Furman. Blake Morgan racked up 147 yards and a touchdown of his own as the 20th ranked team in the nation responded with 24 unanswered points en route to a 24-7 victory. Quay Holmes' performance earned him Offensive Player of the Week honors in ETSU's victory over Mercer. The redshirt sophomore rushed for 255 yards and a career-best 3 touchdowns in the Bucks' 38-33 home triumph over the Mercer Bears. Western Carolina's Jaden Pauling was named Defensive Player of the Week. He joined Samford return man Montrell Washington, who garnered the Special Teams Player of the Week nod for his 59-yard touchdown on a punt return late in the first quarter. When all was said and done, it was Samford 31, Western Carolina 13. Chattanooga rallied from a 13-point deficit in the fourth quarter to come out on top in their contest with the Citadel. A 12-yard touchdown run from quarterback Nick Tiano with just 28 seconds on the clock served as the stunner in a game in which the Citadel was outscored by the Mocs 22-7 in the final period, setting the closing tally at 34-33 Chattanooga. Reese Udinski threw for over 200 yards in the memorable trip to West Point for VMI. 47-6 would be the final as the Keydets closed out the non-conference portion of their 2019 campaign. A number of teams are stepping out of the conference on this 23rd day of November. Western Carolina will be on the road, tangling with the Alabama Crimson Tide, while Samford is also in the state of Alabama. In-state foe Auburn will be on the docket. It is Point traveling to Furman. ETSU is on the road at Vanderbilt, and Mercer makes the trip to take on Mac Brown's North Carolina Tar Heels. Two league games are on the slate. Wofford finishes up its league portion of the schedule, trying to win the Southern Conference outright at the Citadel, and Chattanooga travels to Lexington to take on VMI.
What a season it's been in the Southern Conference. We appreciate you joining us each week for SoCon Football Weekly, presented by Catapult.
Back live in Greenville, South Carolina, the Furman Paladins and the Point Skyhawks. Regular season finale. Furman's up 43-7. Along with Coach Sam White, I'm Bob Mahalik. Glad you could be with us. If you missed anything from the first half, well, we'll get you all caught up right here. The Skyhawks showed up ready to play a football game. Even though they're the massive underdog in NAIA school, Timothy Gary had that big play. Point was unable to score. Defensively, Point put some pressure on the Paladins early. And throughout the game, they forced a turnover and then had Furman put the ball on the floor. But Darren Granger, starting quarterback for the Paladins today, settled in, takes it in for a run. Throws a touchdown on the very next possession, this one to Ryan DeLuca. The Paladins go out to a 14-0 lead for Darren Granger, 3 of 5, 32 yards in the first half. And here's the big play. It comes from the defense. Travis Blackshear with the pick six as the freshman gets his first career touchdown as a Furman Paladin. The defense has done a great job for Furman, putting pressure on the Skyhawks. They've got 3 sacks in the football game. The special teams, they've got a safety. They've got this big punt return from Callie Chizik. Coach Sam Weich, Furman's got it done at every level of the game. Offense, defense, and special teams. And when you've got Devin Wynn carrying the rock, well, you know you're going to get something from him, 74 yards and a touchdown.
Well, that was the objective of a game like this. You want to make sure you sharpen all areas of the game, get ready for the playoffs, go in there and play like we did most of the season. We had a couple of games, Walford being one of them, Citadel another one, where we didn't play as well, but you're getting your guys ready for a chance to still be national champions. You can go all the way. That means you got to beat North Dakota State.
Well, they're beating Point. Point did get that touchdown. Probably the play of the game was the gamble one-handed catch there in the end zone for the Point Skyhawks. But Wayne Anderson got the final touchdown of the first half, and it's the Paladins with the 43-7 lead in a first half that saw Thomas Gordon, one of the few seniors on this roster, become the Paladins' all-time leading receiver yardage-wise. Thomas Gordon with 67 yards receiving in this football game to put him over the top. Now, Point comes into this game. We talked about Marquez Jackson being a strong runner, averaging about 54 yards per game. Well, they're going backwards. So when you look at the stats, you got a negative 17 trying to run the football. You're in big trouble.
Yeah, Furman's done a good job. I mean, this is, Point is not giving up. They playing hard. Furman is just a better football team. And they deserve to be ahead like they are. They really have earned every bit of it.
Well, the Paladins have 30 more minutes to get fine-tuned before they find out who and where as far as the postseason goes. We'll be back with the second half kickoff here in Greenville in a moment. third quarter about to begin here in Greenville, South Carolina. Paladin Stadium, Furman out 43-7 over Point, along with Coach Sam White. I'm Bob Mahala. Glad you could be with us for the final second half of the regular season. And a short pooch kick to the 35, taken by the Skyhawks, who get great field position now at the 43-yard line. So the Paladins come out and do the little chip kick instead of kicking it deep.
Yeah, in fact, Atkins just took a two-step as if he was kicking a field goal and tried to hit it as high as he could. And that is a difference. There's a difference between a pooch kick and an onside kick. Onside kick, you're trying to make sure that ball hits the ground before it goes 10 yards. Otherwise, you have to give them the right for a fair catch. But there is no fair catch if the ball touches the ground before it goes 10 yards. Pooch kick, you're just going to pop it over the top, hope somebody that's not used to handling a kickoff return tries to handle it and mishandles it. We did that against, when I was coaching, we did it against the Houston Oilers one time and won the game 61-7.
Against
Glanville?
You think
Glanville? That was fair against Jerry Glanville, yeah.
You're not the only one that did that against Glanville, or tried to at least, who enjoyed it. Adrian Hope gets in and makes the stop of Jackson. Third tackle of the game for Adrian Hope. Those were good times back in the AFC Central there.
Oh yeah, well they were all rivals and they were fun games but we were the only team running the no huddle at the time and we could score. Same year we beat Dallas 50-7 as well, so we were scoring a lot of points.
Well, it's a complete opposite here. The respect amongst these two coaches who were former teammates, Hendricks and Dixon. We won't see much of that.
No, I think. Coach Hendricks will be respectful of the competitive nature of the game, and the record is 69 points anyway. That's a pretty good number that Furman would have to reach in the second half with a lot of their younger guys playing, we expect.
They have rotated players in and out. In this situation, you see there was Adrian Hope in the game, one of the primetime players in the SoCon. He's in the lineup. But the secondary for the Paladins, the two safeties, the starting safeties are out, the backups are in. So they've been kind of mixing and matching some of the backups in with some of the regulars. Hasn't been wholesale changes.
Yeah, that's the best way to go, too. You want some of the leadership on the field. Leadership being the guys that played it regularly.
Pass complete for a first down. Good coverage by Weems, but the ball is still caught.
Yeah.
That was Morris. Bashawn Morris is a freshman. Guess what state he's from?
Confident throw, too. You're throwing that ball right into tight coverage.
The young man from Augusta, Georgia, able to make the grab on a little bit of a duck. Had a hand in there from Weems and still able to hold on to it.
Good play by Point University out of West Point, Georgia.
Right on the border of Alabama. Close to Auburn.
Yeah.
And a first down in Furman territory. Jackson can't quite get to the outside. Jordan Willis with a stop.
Yep, they've tried to hit it up the middle. Got the completed pass, then going wide. Using every style of play in their offense. Not in a hurry-up mode here. This is a spot on the... With the score spread as wide as it is, this is get down there, score some points. Don't try to outscore Furman in the second half. Let's just get this thing back to where we feel good about ourselves if you're Point University.
Wise with the rollout. Tries to tuck it up and run and is slammed to the turf. Cameron Coleman with his second tackle of the football game.
I'll tell you, Bob, going when you finish a second half like this, and I've been in a few games like this, I'll leave it at that, but you don't want your team letting up at some point in this game feeling, all right, it's all over with, let's just don't get hurt. That's when you do get hurt.
Well, you saw the enthusiasm on the sideline there as Coleman came off the field. The players who don't get a lot of playing time will play with the motion. They'll play with the energy that you want.
That's good to see, too. See the veteran guys celebrating success on the field with a young guy.
Well, they've been beating up on him in practice for 12 weeks now.
Yeah, that
they
too.
They deserve a little bit of fun. Pass is intercepted. Hugh Ryan, the freshman from Columbia down at Irmo High School.
Well, that is keeping your eye on the ball, too. That looked like it went right through the hands of the receiver.
Pilots get their second interception of the game. Hamp Sisson in at quarterback for the Furman Paladins here for the third quarter. Devin Wynn still on the game. Wynn had 74 yards rushing in the first half. Picks up two on first down. So Wynn working towards another 100-yard game after going over the 1,000-yard mark last week in Spartanburg against Wofford. Preseason All-SoCon. Should be an All-SoCon performer at the end of the season as well. And as coach has pointed out many times, coming back for his senior year. Option to win. Close to the first down marker. Before he's ridden out of bounds by Quan Neal.
And that may be the strategy or the objective of this one is to get him 100 yards, finish the regular season with 100-yard rushing for Devin Wynn and get ready for those playoffs. But they don't want to get him nicked up and unable to play in the playoffs. So I suspect when he hits 100, he's out of there.
Well, the offensive line pretty much intact for the Paladins. Cole Neely is in there at center. They haven't made mass substitutions along the front line yet. They try to control the line of scrimmage and do on third and short and get plenty to keep this drive alive. Out to the 43-yard line.
Enough for a first down. Nice steady drive. Not trying to hit the home run yet.
Devin Abrams now with three carries and 42 yards. That's good numbers for a fullback.
Yes, it is.
For any back.
Good numbers for a good fullback. You can use that adjective twice.
That was a forward pass. Not sure why the whistle wouldn't have blown on that one. It blew earlier. Ryan Miller falls on it. They're going to say that ball was live?
Yeah, they're marking it.
They're going to say that was live. That looked like a forward pass for sure.
Boy, it sure did.
But the whistle didn't blow, and so it was very wise of Miller to focus. You're talking about being focused late in a football game when you're up big, but Miller had the awareness to pounce on it.
Well, being aware of the rules, flat out being aware of the rules. You'd be surprised at how many players don't know the details of some of the less often called rule changes, especially when they're a first-year rule change. That's not a first year, but the fair catch rule last year was a first year, and got Furman one time out at was it Western Carolina or was that Chattanooga? Where was that?
It was up in the mountains. I believe it was at now you're going to throw me off. But, yes, it was – and it cost the Paladins. It probably cost the Paladins a postseason bid last year.
Yeah.
Or, you know, when they took a it was a fair catch, took a knee, and ended up giving terrible field position. Yeah. A safety ensued, and then a touchdown after that, and the Paladins went from being up to giving up 9 quick points, all because of one little fundamental play. They're going to review this pass. Doesn't matter the score. Doesn't matter how much rain has fallen down, as you can see it – plunking off of his bill of his cap. Got to make the right call. They're going to review it to make sure that it was indeed a lateral. If it's an incomplete pass, they'll move the ball up about 7 yards. So it's a play of significance. We'll take another look. Now, it's a little deceiving. He throws it. You can see 3 yards back, and that's definitely a forward pass.
I think it is, too. I think they're going to get in. That was Bob Johnson, by the way.
You know a guy named Bob Johnson. Strange there would be two Bob Johnsons in the world. Well, there you could go. You can see the movement actually is forward. That should solve it right there. But what they need to do is see where the original line of scrimmage was, which was the 42-yard line. So they need to move that back to the 42 and make it a second down and 10 from there.
That may be what they're doing more than making the judgment of a forward pass or a lateral is where do we spot the ball?
By the way, point coming into this ball game. Remember, you are who you are. Furman's a SoCon team. Points in NAI school. But Point comes in here winning 3 out of their last 4. And they won last week against Bluefield 24-6. And they have a winning record in their division. So this is a team Point that at their level is a better than average football team.
Yeah, 6-5 coming in here today. And they're, we don't really know how tough the competition was. I'm sure they had some tough ones during the course of their season. And they won more than they lost.
Well, here's what's funny. As you're watching these two gentlemen discuss the call, they've already moved the ball back to the original line of scrimmage and they're lined up ready to play with a second down and 10 from the 42. That's what you can't see. Now they're going to run up there and go, you guys made the call for us already. We've been over here on the headsets trying to make the call.
You think the secret's already out, is what you're saying.
Yeah, I think so.
Incomplete pass. Okay. That's what that signal meant.
Got to get the call right.
And, of course, they got to get the clock right, too, because a few seconds difference in that recovering a fumble or an incomplete pass.
Anderson in motion takes the pitch. And Wayne Anderson was a touchdown in this game. Picks up 4 on second down.
He's up a 3rd and long. Good defensive effort so far with Point. Holding Furman down to about a, we'll give them 2 yards on 2 tries. One, of course, being 0 with an incomplete pass, but 3rd down and 8.
Sisson will go in the shotgun. 2 receivers split to the bottom of the screen. Anderson in motion. Sisson. Under pressure, steps up, complete. 1st down and many more. Ryan DeLuca looking for his 2nd touchdown of the game, and DeLuca almost breaks free, gets it down to the 23-yard line.
You know, we were talking about Thomas Gordon being a senior key guy going, who's going to be the key guy next year? Well, it could be DeLuca right here. We're looking at next year's go-to guy possibly. He's a junior this year.
Earned his way onto this team coming out of Fort Mill. He was a high school running back, all-state basketball player. He did it all. He was a great jock in high school, and he's one of those kids sort of like Hunter Renfro that you just go, you got to find a place for him on your roster, and Paladins have found one. Hamp Sisson keeps it, scores. Touchdown, 2nd rushing touchdown of the season for Hamp Sisson.
Bob, I want to ask you, I've never heard anybody give an extra. What does hemp stand for? Is that a short for something else?
That's just hemp. It's a unique man with a unique name and a unique game.
Okay, now I got it.
I'll have to check on that one.
I don't believe
he's a Hampton or anything of that nature. I think it's just hemp.
I'm guessing it's a family name, but
Grayson Atkins, extra point is good. We will do due diligence and find out if he's the only hemp in America. Right now, he's the only one leading Furman to a 57 lead. Doesn't seem to matter who's at quarterback for Furman, whether it's Granger right there, number four, or Sisson, who just scored. The Paladins keep putting points on the board. 50-7, Furman with the lead. We've got a lot of football to go. Most points ever scored by the Paladins in a football game, 69.
And a lot of that is a credit to the offensive line, who don't get their names mentioned because they don't have the ball under their arm. There's a good run back.
Yeah, the Skyhawks. Bartley, one of their wide receivers. Another product out of the great state of Georgia.
You know, the offensive line, really and truly, the only reason they don't get mentioned is they don't score touchdowns and they don't make catches. But
they do score touchdowns, right, Coach?
Well, they do. That's the point, yeah. They make touchdowns happen, that's for sure. And they also make catches happen because they protect that quarterback long enough to get the ball off.
Micah Maxey in at quarterback for the Skyhawks. Interesting ball game. We have two teams that alternate quarterbacks. And both are successful.
Right, as a regular routine, and there's not just because of this particular game, but that's been the history throughout this season for both teams.
Clemens up the gut, picks up a first down.
Be close, depends on the spot. Yeah, they call it right now. They're moving the chains. Pace is slowing. Looks slow, but they're going right to the line of scrimmage and getting the ball off pretty quick after the previous snap. Good run.
7-yard pickup on first down. Running in there with gang tackling.
Nice hole, breaks one tackle, picks up another probably 4 yards after the would-be tackle in the backfield.
Yeah, Patrick Wells was the first to make contact but didn't bring him down. A lot of second and third teamers in there now for the Furman Paladins up front.
And point goes back in the huddle. They've been going no huddle there for a couple of snaps. All spread out, got a lot of receivers, quick and hand the ball off to the running back.
And get the first down.
You know, if you get the defense talking to each other, you take him, I'll take this guy, blah, blah, blah. Ball snapped. You're a count late. reacting to where the ball's going, and the advantage goes to the offense, as it did right there, first down point.
Both teams make substitutions. Furman comes all out on a blitz. Maxey stopped behind the line of scrimmage.
Good defense that time, right down the line of scrimmage. You saw a lot of the defense sliding along the line of scrimmage, parallel with the line of scrimmage, not giving ground and trying to make a, you know, catch them at an angle 5 yards downfield. And as a result, they lose 2 yards. Point University loses 2 yards.
Yeah, Wells was the first man there again.
Spread out again, that same formation.
Maxey wants to throw and will. Pass dropped. That was the big tight end who scored a touchdown in the first half. Gamble.
He's the touchdown maker, but since he wasn't in the touchdown, he didn't want any part of that one, I guess.
And that's what you don't want to see, an injury. The Furman Paladin, Savotchka down.
You definitely don't want to see an injury at this stage of the game, late in the game.
So Sokova's down, and I'll take a look. It looked like the hip leg area. See, the big tight end would have had at least a 5 yard pickup. Be interesting to see if Point could get him out into some open field and see what kind of rumbling Gamble can do, and see how many defensive backs want to put their shoulder into a knee that's coming at him from a 6'3", 250 pounder.
Looks like a lower.
Yeah, Matt looks like he's okay, as he'll walk it off.
Yeah, knee or an ankle, but not one of those that you, they wouldn't let him walk off like that if it was something that could be re-injured just by walking. And you believe me, there are a lot of injuries that you don't want any action by the leg or the ankle at that point. He's actually holding his hip. He may have got a knee in the hip or something like that. That'll be all ready to go next week, by next week. Big third down.
Micah Maxey goes down. And for the third time in the game, it's Cameron Coleman. His third tackle, his first sack.
He's looking around for some guys to slap him on the back of the head.
He's played a great game. He's been omnipresent since being out on the field.
He really has played well today. Energized, ready to play.
And again, redshirt freshman. Kelly Chizik back to return the punt. Second time they've got a piece of the. This one is blocked and returnable at the 43-yard line. Second time that the special teams unit of the Furman Paladins has got a hand on a punt. And so Paladins continue to dominate in all three phases of the game. We'll see the offense in a moment as the Paladins have jumped out to a 50-7 lead. It's been raining for 7 straight hours in Greenville, South Carolina. It will rain for a few more hours, but it hasn't really impacted the play of the Paladins as they have run up 50 points on point. And we still got 4 minutes and 33 seconds to go here in the third quarter.
Right up the middle. Work that running game a little bit.
Granger back in at quarterback. There's Roberto, 42. I saw his playing time increase as the season has gone on.
This is valuable experience for guys that haven't had a chance to get many carries in the, in the 2019 season.
Anderson's gotten plenty in this football game, and he gets it down to the 20-yard line, takes a hit late. Anderson scored a touchdown in the first half.
Furman's offense gives the defense a lot of problems because they run an option scheme as a regular part of their offense. They run a straight-ahead blocking, man blocking, zone deep, what they call a zone blocking. And then, of course, they've got the passing game that is outstanding.
Roberto off left side. Plows ahead and picks up 5 on first down.
I think back, Bob, if you think back over the season against Virginia Tech and against Georgia State, two of the top teams that they played, better teams they played. They played there right with them. In fact, held the lead, I think, in both of those games by halftime. And showed a lot of powerhouse. A lot of the guys that played in those games are playing here today and are also going to be playing in this field again next year. Good play by the defense. We should point out that Point doesn't look like they've conceded anything. They're still playing hard. That's a credit to them, credit to the coaching staff. Keep them up.
26 is Chase Abshire into the ballgame. Got the carry there. Redshirt freshman out of Georgia stays in that slot-type position. Granger gives it to Roberto. And Roberto looks like he's got the first down to the 10-yard line. They'll move the sticks and keep moving the clock.
I think I've said this before on air, but the toughest spot on the field is first and goal at the 10 or the 9.5 because you can't run them off. You can't run anybody off. You got an inline there, 10 yards. That's how deep the end zone is. So you're working on a limited field.
Hey, there's Ryan DeLuca. Hey, look, Mom, no gloves. He's made 2 great catches today without the gloves on.
You don't see that very often.
You see this a lot from Furman today, a touchdown. Dominic Roberto.
Good run. Boy, that was a determined run. He was not going to be denied.
Third touchdown of the season for Roberto.
Terrific blocking up front. Gave him the running start, and that was all it took.
And they're up to 56 points. You know, against VMI 2 weeks ago, they tried some backup kickers and did a little bit of things different, but they're going to stick with Grayson Atkins here to keep him in form heading into the postseason. And he drills it right through.
And really
50-point lead. So the Furman Paladins could have maybe gotten a share of the SoCon title without even playing a SoCon game today because Wofford's playing at the Citadel, but the Wofford Terriers take care of business. Wofford, congratulations to the Terriers. They win the SoCon championship. Outright championship as they beat the Citadel today 31-11 down there in Charleston. You see a lot of FBS against FCS, and Alabama put 66 on the Catamounts. Auburn 52 on the Dogs. VMI ahead of Chattanooga. Now, Chattanooga came into that game with a chance possibly to have a share for the title, but looks like Chattanooga's going to learn for the third time, and we've been very impressed all season long with what's going on up in Virginia with VMI. They've become a very competitive team here in the Southern Conference this year.
They sure have. They got one or two players that come in and make a difference in the ball game, in the potential of the team, and it's tough at VMI to recruit, let's just face it. You know, you got to have guys that want to go to a military school, Citadel the same way, of course. But you style your offensive scheme with the players you've got, and you do that. Wofford's done that for years.
Well, points determine the return every kick. They will not take the knee down. They get it out to right around the 25-yard line. So the Wofford Terriers with the win down in the Lowcountry today. And what a great bounce back for the Terriers, who started off slowly, lost to SC State, had a couple early losses, and folks were wondering, boy, what happened with the Terriers? But they turned it on when it mattered most here in the month of November.
They are amazing to me because they have had, last year, of course, they had the great three-point shooter there, McGee, that...
we're talking football.
I know we're talking football, but they find players and have good records in all the sports. They really do.
How about that Furman basketball team, too? Big win last night.
Oh, boy.
Considered one of the best mid-majors. Played very well against Alabama earlier this week. And I tell you, that Furman-Wofford rivalry has now really gone next level on the basketball court. And it's going to be a great season, I think, for both. Both have NCAA potential for sure.
No question about it. Furman is so much fun to watch because they've got those three-point shooters, and they're all over the court. It's not just one or two guys.
And if you haven't been to watch them play, it's a fun environment. Student section shows up, and you could probably meet a legend like Sam White sitting there. He doesn't miss a game, do you?
I don't miss a game. I'll have fun.
They're a fun team to watch.
You know what is a sidebar here? We're still watching the football game, but we're talking basketball in a second. Is that the other sports, for example, the lacrosse and the volleyball team, so they'll all show up to watch the Furman basketball game. They sit together and cheer.
It's great.
And the atmosphere is just terrific. And back to football.
Rain's coming down as hard as it has all day. This is the end of the front. If you want to get into that weather guy thing, this is the final push out of the front. Yeah, this is the worst stuff. It'll be nice for you on your ride home.
You know
the
all
big
those.
Tight end, Gamble, looks like he's got the first down. By the way, the Furman women's cross-country team today competing on the national level, finishing ninth in the nation.
Wow.
Outstanding performance. They've got a couple of All-Americans. So as you talk about how football is supported by a lot of the other teams, I know that a lot of the athletes who play football also are supportive of cross country and baseball and basketball, and they're student athletes. They have that common commitment. They know what it's like to have to juggle academics and athletics, and right now Furman's doing it better than anybody. The 17th ranked team in the nation has a 50-point lead as we head to the final fourth quarter of the regular season. Fourth quarter about to begin in Greenville, South Carolina. Point trailing by 50. Maxey, the quarterback, under pressure, gets drilled as he throws it incomplete.
That was not a full 3 seconds of decision-making time for the quarterback that time. Good rush by Furman. Good pressure. Quarterbacks are taught, you know, you got to get rid of that ball less than 3.5 seconds, and they'll hold them out.
Yeah, point usually. With only 72 yards passing in this game. Haven't been much better on the ground. That 2 yard carry doubles their total to 4.
Point doesn't usually get a lot of yards on average passing, though. Running the ball is coming into this ball game was their mainstay, but and today is really kind of a tough day to have a great day passing the ball, just holding on to it.
It's been miserable. I mean, there hasn't been any wind, but it is, the temperature keeps dropping. I would say as the sun sets, but we have had no proof of the sun for the last 7 hours.
Well, I'll tell you, just the dampness, you don't know where the ball is wet, you know. If you got a wet ball and it's solid, and you deal with it. But
nice play out of the backfield.
Sure was.
First down there, and there's that wet football coming free. A late whistle, they'll say he was down by contact. So Tyreek Robinson, one of their sort of big play men, coming out of the backfield for Point.
Yeah.
And Robinson has 5 touchdowns this season. Brought down by Gilby. Oh, that ball was close to coming out. We'll see if they take time to look at it.
Well, that one probably deserves review. If the game were close, they might spend the time to do it, but doesn't look like they're making any effort to.
The Furman bench not making any
effort
to get this play reviewed. It is a 4th and short. 4th and about 3 inches.
Well, that's generous of Coach Hendricks.
And I think now they will have to take a look at it. Again, doesn't matter about the score. Doesn't matter how cold and rainy it is. You got to play it by the book. There are rules, and they're going to have to review this play to make sure it wasn't a fumble. Now, the whistle did blow, so you have to wonder if even it wasn't down by contact that the inadvertent whistle would have stopped the play, but they'll give it a quick review, and we'll see if Robinson did fumble the football or if it's going to be a 4th down and inches.
Well, you're right. You do have to play by the rules, I probably brought up extenuating circumstances that should not be brought up.
Well, but what you're getting at is there's no way Furman's going to challenge this play. You know, they're going to let it take care of the booth. But let's take a look. Yeah. There's the strip. Ball's coming free. That's a fumble.
Oh, that's a fumble for sure. Now the question will be, do they call it an inadvertent whistle, which will stop the play at the point of the whistle?
Paladins did recover on the sideline before it went out of bounds.
It sure looked like it.
At the 45-yard line.
And I don't think he stepped out with his foot before he recovered that fumble.
He did not. Looked like Hugh Ryan, by the way, who had an interception earlier in the game. So Ryan, 48, getting some playing time. If that stands, he'll have an interception and a fumble recovery.
Yeah.
It's a way to finish out the regular season.
It should be a fumble and recover Furman.
They may be checking on the whistle now to make sure the whistle didn't stop play. This is a tough situation for Point. We get it. Furman's up by 50. They've got a playoff game to look forward to next week. The only thing Point has to look forward to right now is a soggy bus ride home all the way down to the border of Georgia and Alabama. So, you know, Point's got to hang in there. Hey, Coach, let's take a look ahead. We got the playoffs next week, but let's look ahead.
All right.
You're the one who's big on this. This Furman team is young and talented, and they're not losing a ton at the end of this season, whenever that is.
Yeah. Read it down. All right. It is a turnover. But if you look at it, all their quarterbacks are coming back. All their starting running backs are coming back, with the exception of Goodwin
Thomas Gordon, wide receiver.
Yeah, offensive line. And Gordon, of course, is here. Important guy, but he's got a lot of good players around him, and all the tight ends are returning. That is a strong return. Now, defensively, they are losing 4 good players. And of course, on special teams, you get a lot of guys. But defensively, you lose Tibbs and Willis, 2 valuable people. Perryman, very valuable linebacker. And the defensive backs are losing three key guys as well. They have been place kicker, one of the best, the best in the SoCon and one of the best in the nation. So they're getting hit there.
Yeah, Brian Okay, the safety, I think he's just been a terrific player for this Paladin team over the last 4 years. And if they continue to play well in the postseason, hopefully he'll get some even more attention. But I think he's somebody that's going to be not easily replaceable. He's a veteran. He plays 30-plus games. And while they have the skill and the talent, they do have to find some leadership in that secondary next year at the safety position. So the Paladins, though, while we look ahead to next year and all these players coming back, they still have a postseason to contend with. And they could be a huge factor, especially if they begin at home. We will find out tomorrow at 12:30 who the Paladins will play and where they will play. You can turn into ESPNU to see the brackets come down. New quarterback in the game, Jack Harden. Third quarterback used by the Paladins. Harden got some playing time against VMI 2 weeks ago. He also scored on a two-point conversion in that VMI game. He'll run the option. And the pitch is dropped. Wayne Anderson couldn't quite handle it. They'll lose a big chunk.
Looks like a pretty good pitch. Sometimes they just don't stick when they get there.
And Anderson pointing to himself saying, that's not on the new QB, that's on me.
Yeah.
And that hurts Anderson's stats. He was putting up a pretty good stat line.
Nice little warmer right there, by the way. When he gets through keeping his hands and fingertips warm, he'll push that around to the back so it doesn't get in his way. Slides around. Well, I lied to you. He didn't. You keep it in front.
We'll see if they let Harden throw the football on third down and 14. They'll run it. And it is Wayne Anderson who gets to the corner. Head down, barrels forward. Will come up shy of the first down, marked at about the 46-yard line.
Now what do you do if you're Coach Hendricks, Bob Mahalik? You got a fourth down and less than two.
I think you run the football. I think you go for it.
Yeah,
you just chew up some clock, right?
Yep.
Maybe not.
Clock is running.
Paladins will send in the punting unit.
Yeah. And this is just conceding the idea that you can't make 2 yards. You're just not running the score up. Basically, that's what's happening right now.
We'll go backup punter.
I don't remember. Has he got a punt on the year, Bob? I don't think so. At least I don't remember it.
Well, that's Timmy Bleak Road. I believe, and see, I should know this information since it's
yes,
my job
should.
Here. But he had the
shouldn't take you this long to explain why you don't.
Tried to kick the field goal against VMI and put it off the upright. But he'll get this punt away. That's a pretty good one. Take a good bounce. And any time you are punting and that ball gets down inside the 10, down to the 5-yard line, you've done your job. Way to go, Timmy. Still going. They'll mark it down at the 4-yard line.
Oh, boy.
Difficult field position for point. They trail by 50 in the fourth quarter here in Greenville, South Carolina. There's Timmy Bleakroad. That was his second punt. His first punt was a 53-yarder this season. His second punt pins the team down inside the 5-yard line, and I would like to correct myself, please. It wasn't Timmy who dinged one off the uprights last week or 2 weeks ago. It was Knox Keeman. So multiple kickers in the game against VMI. So,
I won't be able to sleep tonight. Thank goodness.
I cleared that up for you. All right. Second down now inside their own 5-yard line for point. They've been trapped inside their own 10 a couple of times. Pylons do have a safety. There was a high snap on a punt that went out of the back of the end zone for 2 points in the first quarter.
Pylons playing just a pure man-to-man right there. They're expecting the run for them to punch it out a little bit. And third down here, though, they could go to the air. Let's see what the Pylons do defensively. This young group of guys.
Yeah, that was Bryce McCormick, freshman from Franklin, Tennessee. That graphic we had up earlier of all the players returning for Furman. There's still plenty of work to do in 2019, but 2020 should be another year in which the Paladins begin the year as considered a preseason SoCon favorite. Pass deflected and intercepted. They say no, it hit the ground. Cam Brinson almost scooped it.
So we get a close look. There's the tip. Yep, and they say the ground helped him hold on to that ball, but still tough situation, backed up. He'll be close to that end line when he lines up to punt this one. About 2 or 3 yards, he's got some cushion.
And Nick Partlow was in at quarterback there for a point. Third quarterback used by the Skyhawks. See if they can get the snap down. The snap's been high frequently in this game. That one's right in the gut and he's able to get it away. Chizik calls for a fair catch, but can't quite get his hands on the line drive. And that'll take a long roll. That's the best punt of the day for point.
I would say about a third of it was on the roll. That was about as long.
Look like your tee shot. Doesn't matter as long as it gets there, right, Coach?
That's it. That's the rule.
Paladins up 50. Coach Sam White says you just got to not necessarily enjoy the music, just move to keep warm. There you go. You're not going to keep dry. We promise you that. There's no dry to be had here in Greenville, South Carolina. If you are still around here at Paladin Stadium, you are a diehard or a parent.
Or a parent is correct. Grandma, grandpa counts.
A lot of room up the gut. Oh, football comes free. Players are hurting down. Point has it. Ball still loose. Whistle still hasn't blown. Now it does, but that was a big time fourth quarter collision. There's another Furman player down from the mad scramble back the play alignment. What a run up the gut.
Straight shot, pops into the hole. He's moving that ball around just a little bit, but.
Yeah, Jack Owen lowered the helmet.
You don't lower your head, and that's exactly what he did.
Actually, that was Christensen. Excuse me, that's Coleman Christensen, a freshman from Texas, and he got a little bit too low. You don't lower the head that much, and he got low on low. Got drilled by McFarland. McFarland took a big blow as well. Ball came free, and behind the play.
It looked like everyone involved got stunned on that one a little bit.
And ironically, they just made the targeting call, and I believe they made the targeting call against Point. But I got to tell you, Christensen did a pretty good job of instigating the contact there.
Yeah, I don't think they're going to – I don't think the targeting will stand up on that one.
They are going to review it. Cole Neely, one of the veteran linemen, comes walking off. He was injured on the play, but he appears to be okay. And now we'll review the targeting call. Boy, that was a big-time collision. In the defense of Christensen, who's coming through the gut, you know, he's a 5'11", 205-pound freshman, Coleman Christensen, number 29 for the Paladins. He's coming through the gut. I think he's expecting a linebacker to hit him 2 or 3 yards after he had the football. Yeah. Nobody was there. And all of a sudden, he was going full speed
right
at his first contact.
Yeah, that hole opened up just as he arrived at the line of scrimmage. The hole opened up. He accelerated, which he's supposed to do, but you never, ever lower your head like that.
On offense or defense, I will tell you, Coach,
right.
They say it was a tougher game back when you played in the 70s and the 80s, and it was a mean game. I don't recall too many guys lowering the head as often as I see it every day, college and pro, every weekend when I'm watching a game.
I think
with your shoulders.
I think they may have done that. That is he almost letting go of the ball at the instant that he hits, and the contact is initiated by him, so no one else. Oh, no. I don't agree with this.
Well, call stand. Player is ejected, and player safety, of course, is paramount. Won't have too much of an impact on the game, but, again, the message,
yeah,
those coaching young people, it's your shoulder. You don't lower your head on offense. You don't lower your head on defense. You use the shoulder. And that's an unfortunate situation as McFarland now will exit the ball game, which down by 50 in a pouring rain might not be a bad thing. He gets to go to the locker room and hopefully get healthy. And it appeared that everybody was okay on the play. The two men involved in the collision are fine. Behind the play, Neely appeared to be fine. Football was eventually recovered, they say, by Furman. So the Paladins hang on to the football, and a whole lot going on there in a 50-point game late in the fourth quarter.
And it's all wrapped around safety, trying to make sure that the game is a little bit safer by not having that, head-to-head contact. But it's supposed to be something that takes place where the defensive guy initiates the contact. And I just didn't see that there. But the officials did, and they're the only ones that count. So here we go. Furman got 15 yards out of it and a first down.
9:40 to go in the fourth quarter.
I think they've got everything together. They've got to get the clock right and the hash mark right and, of course, how many yards they mark off to where they're now starting, first and 10.
Jeff McElveen is the lone setback.
Oh.
Paladins moved. That'll be 5 yards against Furman.
Yep, that play did not happen. When they when you have illegal procedure, illegal motion like that, or there's a signal for it, the play stops. That's the end of that play right there. Now, most of the time you can't stop it because everybody else, crowd yelling, and the crowd hears this deafening noise. Not today, of course.
As
the play
Wilson.
Is already stopped. It wouldn't matter whether he ran for a touchdown or got knocked back for a 10-yard loss. It's going to be a 5-yard penalty against the Paladins.
Clock will keep ticking. Harden under center. McElveen with the carry. And he gets one, maybe two. Ball comes free. But the Paladins fall back on top of it. It looks like Point came out with the football. Cameron Weems is holding the rock, but he doesn't get to keep it.
Everybody's kind of looking around like, what's next? Here we go. I don't believe they brought in a fresh ball either. I think that's the same football from the previous play. It's been all over the ground. Let's hold on. Paladin's got to be careful about the fumble right here on this snap. Good snap, clean handoff. Good locked up arm over arm carry of the ball. Fundamentals are good.
Some backup linemen in there for the Furman Paladins. Anderson Tomlin, one of them, redshirt freshman out of Birmingham. Getting a few snaps.
Furman taking all 40 seconds of the time between snaps.
See 74, the right guard there. We want to honor 74. That's Cody Wyatt, a senior, playing in his final game for the Furman Paladins. So you get to see a senior in the final home game, getting some quality playing time here in the fourth quarter. Third down run will be way shy of the first down. So it'll be fourth and 10. There's Cody.
Congratulations. Not only of, you know, 4 years of football, but 4 years of getting a degree from Furman University, then that paper counts for something. That's any employer looking at a Furman graduate is impressed by the fact that they are what that degree stands for. 4 years or 5 years of training and information that will carry them a long way in life.
And to know that you had the discipline to not only get a degree from Furman, but do it while participating full-time in athletics.
Yep.
So as you have the discipline to be a success in what people call the real world, well, this is very real. Furman's up by 50 late in the fourth. Back in Greenville, South Carolina, where Julius Dixon returns to his alma mater as head coach of Point. And right now, his Skyhawks taking a big jump up in play from NAI to playing in FCS, down by 50 to the Paladins, 57-7. Had mentioned that the Skyhawks began the season playing Kennesaw State. Kennesaw State beat them 59-0. Kennesaw State is on the board, and that could be the team the Paladins play next week in the first round of the playoffs.
I think they are right now probably the best bet if you're laying down some odds.
Austin Peay, Towson State also probably in the mix. Again, the committee will try and give you a bus trip. They'll try and cut down expenses and keep you regional. But if that can't happen and someone's going in the air, I mean, Paladins could be hosting a team from the West Coast. They could be hosting a team from the Northeast. Or they could be in Atlanta playing Kennesaw. All kinds of options. We'll find out tomorrow at 12:30.
You know, Kennesaw State, last time they came to Furman, they won the ball game pretty handily against the Paladins several years ago.
Yep, home opener 2 years ago.
2 years ago, was it? Well, they are probably got a lot of the guys still on that roster that played in that ball game.
As we mentioned, Point now going with another quarterback, Nick Partlow. Almost got picked on his previous throw of the opening drive of his game, and he fumbles it there. So he's put the ball on the turf a couple of times. We'll unpal and see who has it. It will remain Point football. So he almost got picked on his first drive, and he puts the ball on the wet turf as Taylor Hodge, the nose guard, got in there to strip it away.
Well, that the ball must looked like he was recovered, and they were still diving for it, so somebody must have squirted out a little bit.
Point will punt again. They've had some troubles with the snap. They've had one go over the head for a safety. They've had two blocked.
Got an extra blocker back there that they didn't have in the last one.
Short kick. Chiswick will let it bounce.
Kind of a...
It's like not Chiswick. It's
drew
the
string back on that one. Didn't follow through with that all the way to the top. He wanted to make sure he got his foot on that one.
So the top 24 teams in FCS feel like they're going to get the playoff bid. So the top eight will get a bye. And then you've got 16 teams that will make the playoffs, and they'll play each other. No seeds. They'll just match them up. Here is your buffet that you're going to pick from. You wonder if Wofford could squeeze into the top eight. If they do, they get the bye, and that certainly could change things for Furman as far as getting that regional competition. Of course, Wofford and nearby Spartanburg, and you have Kennesaw in the mix. Maybe we'll put that board back up in a minute. There are a lot of very good football teams there. A team like Kennesaw certainly will put in a bid to host a game. They've got finances and support there in that Atlanta area school. Wofford certainly, if they're not getting the bye, would be considered almost a lock, I think, being the SoCon champ to have a home game. And I think you would wish that. Even if Furman and Wofford are rivals, you want Wofford to get the respect they deserve for being the conference champ of your conference.
Right. All of those variables come into play, and you've got one group probably of 7 to 10 guys, or men and women, that are making that decision. And what time did you say that comes out?
12:30
tomorrow. 12:30 tomorrow.
ESPNU.
All right.
And, of course, you'll be following on Twitter, right? Follow the Furman Paladins on Twitter.
I'll be following on Twitter, much like Point was following the ball
Chase
carrier.
Great social media at Furman University, by the way.
Oh.
Quick and easy messages to get out there on the Twitter accounts for basketball, football, and for all athletics and all other sports. There's a nice power run there, right, from Jeff McElveen. Scored a touchdown a couple weeks ago.
Furman with another first down.
Milk and clock, under three.
Young
final
guys
game
on the field right now would like to score one more for family and friends that are watching the ball game.
Harden with the handoff.
I'm going to try just to power this one. I think they're going to use the clock and also run right at them and mano-mano find out who can win and who can score another touchdown and what defense can hold them back. These 22 guys are going to decide that.
So the Furman Paladins regular season is going to come to an end. They will get the 8-win season. They'll be 8-4. They have 4 losses. 2 of the losses are highlights of the season. Games they could have won at Georgia State and VMI when they stepped up in competition. The 2 losses are heartbreaking. Brutal to in-state opponents, the Citadel and Wofford. And most of the wins have been kind of no-doubters. So it's sort of been a feast or famine for Furman. They've either played extremely well, and they've just had those 2 games in conference against the Citadel and Wofford where they just couldn't get it to click. So if you're going to play Furman next week in the playoffs and you're getting the Furman team the good Furman team, very good that we've seen on occasion,
well,
you could be
in some
trouble.
Well, in the big picture, too, and I think I've said this a couple of times today even, is that they're taking the right steps forward. They're getting better and better. They're getting stronger where they happen to have a weakness the year before. They'll be looking for some defensive talent to be recruited and hopefully signed, because that's where they're losing most of their depth. Running backs coming back, exception of their top receiver. They've got a lot of receivers, and another touchdown being scored right at the end of the game here.
Yeah, Jack Harden.
Jack Harden makes a terrific decision not to touch it, let anybody else hold the ball. He just carried it right on in himself.
30-yard touchdown run for Jack Harden, the redshirt sophomore out of Roswell, Georgia, from Fellowship Christian School. First touchdown as a Paladin. Dud has a two-point conversion. That's his first touchdown. Congratulations.
Good bit of speed. Fellowship Christian School, by the way, Point University is a Christian-based school as well. So their alumni should be happy to hear that we got that in, because I'm sure they're proud of it.
Hey, and Knox won through. He got the extra point. We mentioned earlier he had the backup kicker had missed one there in the game against VMI. But Keenan puts it through, and it's a 64-point game for the Furman Paladins. They take the 64-7 lead. You know, I think next week, I think the Paladins are going to be at home against Towson.
Against who?
Against Towson. Towson State. That's my
you
guess.
You do. That's your
pick. That's my guess.
You're taking Kennesaw State off the table then.
I'm thinking Kennesaw is going to host somebody else, because I think Wofford may slide into the top eight. But if Wofford, I think if Wofford isn't in the top eight, I think then Wofford will probably draw Towson and Furman. So the Paladins with that 64-7 lead. Getting ready for next week. You don't like that prediction? I like that prediction. I'm going with it.
Yeah.
You know, it's like when you fill out your bracket, you try and guess what the committee is going to do before the big dance.
Well, as you know, I'm always interested in your opinion.
That's just a shot in the dark there, that's all. And then when it comes true, I'll brag about it for like a couple of months.
Forever.
When it doesn't, I'll just pretend it didn't happen. But we know the Paladins are playing next week. We hope it's here at Paladin Stadium. And if you're a fan of the Paladins, we certainly hope you show up.
Short
Nothing like
kick.
Postseason football.
Yeah. One hopper on the receive of that kickoff with about a minute and 25 seconds left.
Hey, by the way, can I say one more thing while I'm on this slight
you
soapbox
sure
here? Why not? I think that in all of college athletics, and maybe even in professional sports, that the way you determine a championship here at FCS is the best way of doing it.
Yeah.
Top eight get a bye. 16 other teams get in and get a chance. You host a game if you deserve it, and you play it on the field.
And as a byproduct, there's more revenue coming into those schools.
And you got weeks to play football.
Yeah.
There are a lot of FBS teams playing a lot of FCS teams this weekend. There's a flag on the play. Can't grab that much face mask. Didn't intend to do it. But Jack Barton is going to get flagged.
The only catch into your theory there of having those top eight play the winners of the lower 16 is that the season extends itself, and you are playing already a long season in a very physical game where you do have injuries. So that would probably be somebody's argument against that, but I agree with you.
I think
football is the most popular sport. I think it surpasses baseball or basketball as the most popular team sport out there. And so more games being played would make everybody happy.
But it's less teams, too. It's not like everybody's going to end up playing a 15 or 16 games. And trust me, those bumps and bruises when you're in the semifinals of the national championship, they don't hurt as much, right, Coach?
Yeah, they heal up. They sure do.
It's just a way to settle it on the field. And you don't get punished for that one bad week. You know, Citadel game here a month ago. You know, if it was homecoming, Furman was on a roll, ranked in the top 10 of the nation, and it just didn't click against the Citadel.
Right.
But it didn't end their season.
Yep.
You know, if they win that game, they're in much better shape, and they get a bye, and they have the SoCon championship. But that game doesn't end their season. You could have a couple of weeks where you're not at your best and still have a chance to redeem yourself at the end of the year.
Oh, you're right. I mean, I think everybody would like to see more football games played.
Maybe that's it. That's the selfish part, right? And at a high level. I mean, you'd you know, instead of seeing Mercer lose by 55 at Auburn, you'd rather see, you know, Mercer playing somebody that in their own.
Yep. Somebody that stack them up like Furman just stacked up Point University.
We're going to have to snap it one more time. Coach, it's been a pleasure. Great season. Always good to see you.
Yep, it has been fun, and we have fun up here mainly because the people that are not on camera, the guys that are running those cameras and that are making the decisions back in the production room are doing a terrific job and appreciate their help.
On a cold, rainy day, they're here hours before anybody shows up setting up. They'll be here for hours afterwards tearing down, and then they'll move on to the next basketball game, lacrosse match, or volleyball game. But that's it. The regular season has come to an end. Furman finishes with an outstanding performance as they beat Point 64-7 as the final. Furman, the 17th-ranked team of the nation, gets their eighth win of the season, and now they will sit back, turn on ESPNU tomorrow at 12:30, and see where they will be playing and who they will be playing in the first round of the FCS playoffs. So for Coach Sam White, I'm Bob Mihalik saying so long from Paladin Stadium, where the final score is Furman 64.7. And remember, all games airing on the ESPN networks are streaming live and archived on the ESPN app. This has been a presentation of ESPN.